and welcome to a new episode of the Game Informer Show. I'm your host, Ben Hansen, joined by Andy McNamara at the end of the table.
Hello. How are you doing?
Good. It's been a while. Welcome back,
yeah,
sir.
Thanks.
We got Andrew Reiner.
I like how your enthusiasm was here for him, and then it was like here for me.
You play
That's probably
games.
Right.
You play so many games you're on like every other week, Reiner, and I feel like I interact with you more on a daily basis, whereas Andy just floats down from the clouds every once in a while and graces us with his presence.
Wow, lordly Andy.
You're a common card, I'm a rare or a legendary, you know what I mean?
Yeah. Like he's that skin you're really jonesing for in Overwatch.
I mean, come on.
The Andy skin. Oh, we also have Kimberly Wallace.
Yes, I guess I'm in between a rare.
Sure, you're cool. That's fine.
Uncommon.
Uncommon, yeah.
So this show, we're mopping up some E3 stuff because these two guys at the end of the table have seen... They saw a lot at E3,
a lot of behind closed doors
demos, stuff like that. So some stuff we didn't talk about last week, we'll cover this week. And then it turns out that even this week, games are already coming out. The industry doesn't take a break for E3.
Yeah. What?
Yeah, I know.
It's bizarre.
It's crazy.
So covering some new stuff there. And then the back half of the show, after emails, and everybody sent in a lot of good E3 emails. Thanks for that. But the back half of the show, we're talking to Stephane D'Astous, who's the former general manager over for Eidos Montreal. He left like 3 years ago, but he was there, started that entire studio and built it up, developed Deus Ex, Thief, and whatnot. Mm-hmm. So it's an inside look into the formation and history of that studio. Got to talk to him about my favorite topic, which is like working with Square and the division between East and West and like what the Western teams think of the Final Fantasy resources and effort that gets put behind those games, the different development styles. So it's an interesting chat. Talked about like being at working with Microsoft and Sony for the transition to the new consoles and how secret they were. So in this age of Scorpio and Neo, it's relevant again, I think. So stay tuned for that. Also, he talks about like biggest regrets and the troubled development of Thief and all that stuff. So it's a fun chat. But before we get to that, we should cover the biggest game released this week. Mighty Number 9 with Andrew Reiner.
That's why I'm here. You tricked me.
You did get tricked. I'm
Come down
sure,
talk
yeah.
about the best E3 games, right?
Yeah, that's what you said. I was like, I'm all in.
And now we're going to talk about this thing.
Yeah.
The game everybody is talking about.
That's true.
Yeah.
Okay, so this is the Kickstarter from... 3 or 4 years ago.
Yeah, long time coming.
Mega Man creator Inafune working with Inti
Creator.
Oh, that's
he
right.
He worked on Mega Man. He was an illustrator. He was there for the first game.
Yeah, I forgot about that. So kind of the face of Mega Man, at least.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Said, hey, everybody, give me your money. We'll make a new Mega Man. It's going to be awesome. Rah, rah, rah. And then years and years and years and delays and delays and delays, the game comes out and Reiner gave it a...
Week number 6. That's probably what they should have called it in the end. Yeah, it didn't come together. And, you know, we won't spend too much time on it. But... Level designs are the biggest culprit here. Just uninspired, kind of bland, even just from the art direction, you'd think.
Yeah.
You know, the old Mega Man games really popped. These, you know, look like ordinary offices sometimes. You know, it's just like, man, I want to be in like a cool robotic world. And this really isn't, you know, selling me on that kind of tone. Yet, that's what they're trying to sell, right?
Right. Yeah, I played it last night, just started it up. And that was the biggest thing, at least out of the gate, was, man, this art... is not great. I saw somebody on Twitter compare it to like an early Xbox Live looking game. That seems like an accurate assessment.
Yeah, yeah. And there's some, you know, frame rate issues. I played on Xbox One. It wasn't too bad, but there's a level that's raining and it's going noticeably slower. Almost like a kind of a callback to Super Nintendo. Obviously not intentional.
Right.
But, you know, the dash mechanic works really well. That's where you can kind of zoom across the stage, and there's a thing where you can kind of consume the energy of enemies when you dash through them. That gives you bonuses, like you get a penetrating shot, so you can hit 3 enemies in a row. You get boost to defense, and then your shot itself. So there's a kind of a fun little game within a game of, do I risk injuring myself by dashing through this guy or not? That works well. The boss fights are really, really good.
Oh, wow. Okay.
Very intense and very Mega Man-esque in that, hey, there's certain weapons that certain enemies are weak against. But again, it all falls back onto 90% of those levels just being boring as hell.
And it
just doesn't add up.
I saw they did a live stream and apparently Ben Judd was translating for Inafune. And it seemed like the main culprit that they pointed to for all the delays and the troubles, because there's also been a bunch of tech hassles and Kickstarter disasters about this launch and sending out codes and all that stuff, is they pointed to the fact that they chose to develop for 10 different platforms. Inafune is like, Yeah, we never did that for the old Mega Mans. Like, other houses would handle ports eventually, but just trying to tackle 10 platforms out of the gate.
Wow, yeah.
Turns out it's not easy.
Yeah, and it seems like you want to make everyone happy at once. And
right.
Obviously, we're making a Wii U one, and everybody on Wii U is like, yay, I'll give you money. And then, this disaster happens, right?
Pretty ambitious for, like, your first, like, Kickstarter game to go for 10 platforms. Usually we hear 3, and people even say that's tough. If they don't have a lot of experience doing it by themselves. So it just seems like 10, wow.
So
crazy.
Does it change your guys' outlook on Bloodstained, which was kind of the Castlevania-looking game from the same developer, Inti Creates? It was shown at E3. I didn't really get a chance to see too much of it.
But it actually had a lot of buzz from E3. I actually stayed back at E3 helping here in the office. But so I could kind of see the whole show and like what people were tweeting about. And people who saw Bloodstained seemed pretty high on it.
I think the art already looks better than Mighty No. 9.
Yeah, it all comes down to creative and execution, right? Like, it's not the platform, the vehicle that brought you that game. It's, you know, it's the team behind it. And, you know, we'll see. It looked cool at E3, like Kim said. So,
yeah.
Cross your fingers.
Maybe this can be a little lesson to Bloodstained that got to up your game a little.
Yeah. Somehow try and get
like,
more funding.
But yeah, don't do that.
Don't do that.
I mean, don't talk about this like this is the first bad game ever, that like the video game industry got its first lesson on don't make bad games. I mean,
well, also, yeah, I just felt
we were a little apologist about the whole thing in that, like, you know, a lot of platforms, that's a lot of work for Inafune to do. It's like the guy came out and said, I'm the guy who worked at Capcom for like 20 years making games, made games, and did all this stuff. I made Mega Man. I did all this stuff. He had all these proclamations that made people give him money.
Mm-hmm.
You don't give him an excuse.
Oh,
That's
not an excuse. I'm just saying that was a bad decision to think that you should come out with 10 platforms and be able to deliver quality on all of them. But
that said, it was delayed how long?
Mm-hmm.
And this is what
Several
we ended up getting?
Times.
Like, what happened there?
Right. And everyone's like, oh, Inafune, you con man. It's like, again, not defending him. I understand bad games come out all the time. But it's not like he's pocketing millions of dollars from this, you know. So the con man angle seems a little bit harsh, but everyone is revolting.
The funny thing to me is, out of the gate, they're like, everybody's like, yeah, you're doing the Mega Man. They're like, yeah, we're doing the game you want. We're doing the game you want. And then when the reviews start hitting, I see people from Deep Silver and all that being like, why are you comparing it to Mega Man? That's not fair. And it's like, that's exactly what you were doing.
Now you don't want the comparison.
Right.
But that's how you guys sold it. I think, too, it's interesting as we go through and see more of the, you know, Mike Futter always likes to be like, be very cautious with backing stuff on Kickstarter because of the fact that, you know, even if it is somebody who has a name like Inafune, it doesn't mean the guarantee the product is going to be great. It also doesn't guarantee that it's not going to get delayed. I mean,
Kickstarter, I think one of the lessons that you can learn from Kickstarter is that it has really warped the way people view what it costs or what it takes to make a game. Mm-hmm. I mean, there are certainly teams that can make games in the hundreds of thousands and not need more funding. And then they see someone get, you know, millions and they're like, okay, now they have $2 extra million to make this game. It's going to make it, you know, 6x better than what they pitched me, right? You know what I mean? And it doesn't necessarily work that way. Mm-hmm. And it doesn't necessarily represent like what funding they may be getting behind closed doors or from other people or from other investors. I mean, there's a lot of things at play there, but I mean, it's kind of Kickstarter's own fault, and that's the reason why it's great at the same time too. And I don't know how you fix that, but that's definitely a misrepresentation that's in place there.
Right. Even like Psychonauts 2, big crowdfunding, like they made it very clear that they're still searching for a boatload of money to try and back this thing up. You can't make that big of a 3D platformer with that small of a budget. Crazy stuff. People are a little more skeptical, I think.
I mean, you get burned, obviously. You start questioning everything around it, right?
But, right. There's still plenty of success stories out there.
Oh, yeah.
Don't write it off. But
yeah, I think you just look at this one developer, just, you know, this one instance here and ask what happened. You know, I think that's where you're going to start. Great idea, just didn't pan out.
Yeah, it's a bummer. Hey, let's keep talking about Japan.
Yeah.
All right.
My favorite.
Tokyo Mirage Sessions Sharp FE.
Nope, I'm out.
Horrible name.
Why did you invite me to this one?
I'm asking your impressions on
you
Tokyo
Mirage. You were asking me all about this game this morning and very, very interested. Said you're going to go home and play it right away. I don't know why.
You're not
acting...
even a good liar.
This is the game. I think we've talked about it before, talking about the games that are coming up.
Bad name.
Terrible name. It was originally announced as like Fire Emblem Cross Persona, which seems like a better name.
Shin Megami Tensei, but...
Sorry.
It is more like a Persona. Like, people who play it will feel like it's closer to Persona than like true hardcore SMT. Mm. Although it's still a pretty challenging game.
So. And so this is Wii U JRPG.
Yes. It is over the top and silly, and I hate having to explain this with Andy right here, because here comes the eye rolls, but you actually, I like it because it's silly, because as we know with crossovers, making two universes collide, like, there's never a good reason, like, that you can make for these two universes to cross, so...
I know, cloud fighting Kirby in Smash Brothers is pretty grounded. Pull it off, I think.
So they just went completely silly with it and went all out with this J-pop entertainment scene. And your whole battle system is you performing J-pop star songs to hurt enemies. And
is there like a fake crowd that's like...
Yeah, there's a fake crowd. Like,
oh,
the,
I love it.
The characters will come out in like songs and just like attack. So you have all these different skills you can do. Like, you learn like how to ablib, and then you get to skills will automatically come out. You get duo attacks where two characters will like start singing a song and go and attack. But it's Persona's really fun elemental weakness system and like the hardcore battles of that. To gut around with this. So it's very, very fun.
It sounds like Final Fantasy X-2. Does it feel at all like that with the J-pop?
Yes,
stuff
I guess you could say, but I actually like this more because it doesn't try to be anything other than what it is. Like, it's not presenting itself as a serious RPG, but at the same time, it's also just like a cool look at it. Totally, the things that we look at Japan and are like, oh, like they're, you know, they really have some interesting television shows. And like, there will be just skits of like these, because everybody in your party is like an actor, a model, some form of entertainment, a singer. And they'll show like different TV skits from what they do, different things from their photo shoots. And you have like your talent aid, your headquarters is a whole talent agency, and your talent agent is like a drunk who's always just like, you're interacting with that with her all the time. And then you have like an instructor who teaches you lessons, who's obsessed with anime and always talking about that. And
this
then
is just, oh my
you
God.
Get to go around different places in Japan. So you get to go to like Shibuya, and it's a fashion district, Harajuku, and you can buy clothes in Harajuku. And
so if you have any fleeting interest in Japan, this is just like the most possible Japanese fan service packed into one game.
I will say it to you like this. If you've seen that trailer and you're like, I'm interested in this game, then it's for you. You know if it's for you and you know if it's not. But I will say, like, the dungeons are really interesting. Like, all of them have different themes, you know, within, like, modeling, TV programming, all that stuff. I just, like,
what?
They just...
A modeling-themed dungeon?
Yeah, it's just, like, all the pictures of all the different models. And one, there's, like, a fashion thing where you actually, like, have these giant dresses and you use mannequins to, like, control it so you can raise to go up on different... So there's little puzzles throughout.
Uh-huh.
It's just, there's a lot of creativity in it, and... I had a lot of fun with it.
I think I'm excited about this.
Yeah.
I think
sometimes
I'm
you just want something that's zany like that.
Yeah.
And it's fun. And like I said, the battle system is actually really cool. The whole thing is creating like sessions. So if you attack an enemy weakness, you have a chance for one of your characters to come in to create like a combo chain. And as you progress in the battle system, like you can do these chains with different like them with their different songs and moves that like I had like a 16 chain combo that just kept going on and on and on at the enemy, and it's just really fun.
All right.
So I really dug it.
What'd you end up giving it?
8.25.
That's pretty good. Andy, I hope you're ready for the top 50 games of the year discussion at the end. And by the way, Kim has to champion this again to a...
Well, he's going to live stream that tonight.
I think so.
Are you guys talking?
Damn it.
I was pleasantly surprised. I will say, I just want to set expectations. If you are a Fire Emblem fan, it's less in the Fire Emblem vein. So, like, no strategy gameplay, no relationship system like that. Mm-hmm. Obviously, it is Atlas who developed the game, who is responsible for the Shin Megami Tensei series and Persona. So it really leans to that side. The Fire Emblem characters, how they come to you is that they give your characters the main cast powers. So like Chrome from Awakening, like
you get, it's literally those characters.
Yeah, yeah. So you get like his sword skills, and he's like he helps you throughout. And then you find out what's really cool about it is finding out why the Fire Emblem characters are there, and it's actually they do it in a pretty clever way. But you don't find out till further in the game. I just wish they came in and out of the story a little more than they do, and that they. But there's cool things they implement, like the Master Seal, so you can change your class halfway through to a really powerful one. That's taken straight from Fire Emblem. When you level up, it's like the Fire Emblem theme that you get, and all that. All right.
This sounds fun.
Yeah,
it sounds lighthearted and fun, and it's
a good summer game.
It's not for kids. It's like it's a hardcore RPG in there.
Oh yeah, definitely not for kids.
All right. Oh really? Pretty racy stuff in there.
Is there any sexuality that is like changed for the U.S. market that's going to make people really angry?
Great question, Andy. What's going to enrage everybody?
I don't know if anything's going to. Somebody asked me this on Twitter. They're like, "Oh, is there any like did the censoring or anything? Did you notice anything?" And I said no. Like,
I mean, you'd have to play through the whole Japanese one, right?
This person's wearing too much clothing.
Stuff. I mean, yeah, I didn't see anything that was too terrible or over the top. Or made, like, I will tell people it is just Japanese voice work, so you are just seeing subtitles. I don't know if that's going to bother some people or not. I thought
that's so much more authentic. Thank God.
It
fit the setting, though, right? If the game is in Japan and you're doing all this emphasis on all this stuff around Japan and its entertainment scene, I guess it makes sense.
It's like playing Assassin's Creed 2 in Italian. Like, some people are super into that kind of thing.
I'm going to say, I'm surprised this game made it over here just because it does skew so much towards that Japanese audience.
Yeah.
But I'm kind of really happy that it did.
Yeah. So, I'm excited to check it out.
Yeah.
Sticking with Japanese theme, just, you know, for the rest of the show here before we get to E3, I downloaded the surprise release last week of Rhythm Heaven Megamix on 3DS. It came out last year in Japan. Reiner, have you ever played a Rhythm Heaven game?
Maybe.
Okay. I know we
DS
did one.
Game? Is it like weird little squiggle characters?
Yeah, it's from the WarioWare team. It's very, very WarioWare.
Yeah, I remember that.
Really poppy, fun music in there. And
I didn't like it.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay, the DS one wasn't great. Using
he
the stylus.
Loves his Rhythm Heaven,
I really love Rhythm Heaven a lot. Rhythm Heaven Fever on the Wii, I think, is great. The original GBA one is fantastic. And this gets back to that one where it's just simple button presses. You don't have to swipe the stylus around or anything. And there's a lot of really smart additions. Like before, you'd fail a mission and you'd have no idea exactly why or what happened. But on the bottom screen now, it'll show how off your timing is and also give you like a specific number at the end instead of basically thumbs up or thumbs down. It'll say, oh, you are at 68 or you're at 95 this round. But they also added a lot of characters and dialogue, and so when you go to like
that's amazing.
But they're jokey about it, and that they're like, oh, this isn't some RPG, this is a lighthearted story, sit back and have fun. It's very quirky Nintendo meme-y dialogue, you know, from Treehouse, but it just slows down the pacing of the rhythm games to kind of a frustrating degree. And it also, they remove the remixes, which are the best part of those games, for the first section. You have to wait until later on in the game, and then it'll get back to like classic Rhythm Heaven structure. But if you like music games and you really love WarioWare and you kind of miss that art style and that insane tone, definitely check it out. I'm really having a great time with it. I think Kyle's just starting on the review now, but that'll be coming in. And then one other real quick release before we get to E3 stuff.
I hope it's from Japan.
I was going to say, speaking of Japan, look at his shirt.
Diamond Dog himself over here.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
Could you fan number one on the end of the table?
It's the week after E3. I'm at the bottom of the barrel for shirts.
That's the coolest shirt.
Yeah.
You like that shirt? 80s? I will buy it from you right now.
No, I have that shirt too.
It's awesome. Cool. But also on Tuesday from Jackbox Games, they released Drawful 2. We did a test chamber. It's up on the site. It's on YouTube. It seems really, really good. If you like those party games, you play with your phone. It's basically absurd Pictionary. It's $10. It's on everything that has a computer in it.
Wait, how are they able to put it on so many platforms? Whoa, I'm amazed.
Look at this guy over
here. They must be very experienced game developers.
Very talented down there in Chicago.
Yes.
But the cool thing with Drawful 2 is that you can actually like submit your own prompts this time. So basically, you can like. it feels like you're DMing your own Drawful 2 session where you can write out all these things and force your friends to draw just absurd things. Two colors this time around. Just slam dunk party game. Just go get Drawful 2.
So I guess we're going to put this on like our Extra Life live stream.
Oh my God. Yeah, absolutely. Because they also added something which was in Jackbox Party Pack 2 where if you're streaming it, an audience of up to like 10,000 people can watch it and influence the vote.
Oh, cool.
So it's just ideal for streaming and a lot of really smart decisions like that.
That sounds fun.
And now let's just talk about Umbrella Corps for a while, everybody. No, we haven't checked it out yet. Let's get to E3.
Andy's pissed.
We go. Andy.
I just want to say this is the worst podcast I've ever heard in my life.
Make it better, you Let's go.
If I'm here to make it better, we're all in big trouble.
All right, you and Reiner have been to every single E3.
Yeah.
What'd you think of this one? Did you have a good time?
We did.
Yeah, I think it was I think it was a solid E3. I mean, I kind of came in with the leaks and the kind of various things that I knew going in, the addition of kind of EA doing their own thing at Nokia Live and things like that, the like Doritos thing. I was going in a little pessimistic, let's say, though I know that's pretty much Andy and everything. But yeah, and I think it actually turned out to be a very solid showing for video games and for E3, which I think it still has to kind of get over to some degree, because I think this year, more than any other year, you know, there's a lot of talk of, is this the last E3?
Right. Yeah, Captain Bruisen, just to jump to emails real quick, he actually wrote in and asked that exact thing. What are your thoughts on E3's relevance now and going forward in the future? And where would you rank this E3 against all others you've been to?
I just would never want to see E3 to go away. I just look forward to it so much every year.
Yeah.
And not having that show just feels weird to me.
Yeah, it was weird walking the show floor because half of it, where the first parties were, felt like classic E3, booming, tons of people in there. The space is completely filled. You go into the other hall where there was third parties where EA and Activision pulled out, and half of it was empty.
It was really crazy.
Really weird to see. And you just walked through there pretty quick. I think Andy and I were in and out of there.
We got our work done
there
very quickly.
A couple hours, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, like the Indie Mega Booth is always fun to check out. In our tour, you can see it. But you can also see just a lot of wide open floor space. There was some band playing in a circle of pallets, like pallet Stonehenge over there that was taking up, felt like half the show floor in that one hall. So really bizarre tone. It seems like they're starting to, I don't know, dip their toes in the water of making it a much more public and open event. Like, is that just where this is going? Is just blowing the doors open and having more people come in?
We don't know specifically where it's going. I think there's some important things I think to think about E3. And I like going to E3. I don't think you keep E3 because I like going, right? You know what I mean? Or I have fun. You keep E3 because it's the one opportunity in the year where everyone in the world has their eyes set on video games. Mm-hmm. Right. I think it's really important. Like, you know, my mom knows about E3. My dad knows. You know, they could care less, you know, about video games. But they know this event is important. Right. And they know this is important for video games. I think that's the thing we lost those couple of years when we were in Santa Monica and the year following where we came back to the convention center. But like, there was a hobby convention there at the same time that was in the halls and it dominated. And we were like on the concourse and it literally was depressing. Do you know what I mean? I was like, wow, video games are doomed, you know, and so I think that's really important that we have that. Now, whether it's a public event or an industry event, I think is something that they're struggling with, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, I think they don't know what they want it to be. I'd like to see it stay industry facing, you know, mostly. Maybe it's got some industry days, some you know, community days,
kind of TGS style,
you know, something like that. But I think mixing the two together changes its tone, right? Overall, I think it'll definitely change it to be more about games that are coming out this holiday season rather than like, this is the future of games. And that's like my favorite thing that E3 does, which is, you know, I already kind of know about the games that are coming out in December. I like hearing about like, how are games evolving? Mm-hmm. How are games changing? How is the thing in the future going to change how I play and enjoy games, right? Because they need to always be evolving. I know we play, I mean, a lot of things are the same, right? I get that. But like they have evolved over the year. Go back, play a game on Xbox 360, play a game on PlayStation 3. We're always evolving, getting better. And I want to see where that's going. And I think E3 is important for that.
Well, on that note, let me just get to the big topic here. So Keith wrote in, and because last week on the podcast, we kind of went around the table and talked, or the hotel room floor, and talked about like our top five favorite things that we saw at the show. And Keith writes in and says, okay, I know there was a mild PlayStation lean at GI. I don't think that's true. But seriously, out of 20 picks of what excited you guys at E3, not one single thing from Microsoft?
Dead Rising 4.
Okay, there we go. He said, in fact, I think, quote, suck my butt, Sea of Thieves, was the only Microsoft mention. I mean, come on, guys.
Who said that?
I think it was Elise.
That's pretty good.
I don't remember who said that or why, but so this is a natural segue to talk about Microsoft stuff.
Sure.
To talk about seeing the future and how that really excites you. Let's just get right to Project Scorpio. What did you think about that whole conversation about them kind of unveiling?
Well, let's move back to the beginning of the press conference where they announced the Slim.
Right.
And they kick off their press conference with, here's a new Xbox. It's powerful. It's got a lot of terabytes in it.
Sure.
It's coming out this year. It's cheap. And then they show a bunch of games, and then they end the press conference with, here's the new Xbox. It's not the Slim. That thing we just announced is not the only thing you need to pay attention to. And we're not going to give you many details about it, but it's for VR, and it's 4K.
I heard it's the best quality pixels you've ever seen.
And it comes out 2017, end of year 2017.
Yeah.
So a lot of people walked out of there just confused, like, what should I do? What am I supposed to do? And that's the last thing you want a consumer to do if you're a console manufacturer, is be confused by what they should purchase and what they shouldn't.
Well, I was even like, why would you invest in the Slim knowing that this new, better console's coming out
unless you just
a year later?
Unless you just
like don't have like a 4K TV or whatever.
You don't have a 4K TV and in theory, it'll be a little bit more expensive. I'd imagine them talking about how powerful it is. And so maybe it's like, oh, if you want the cheaper route and you like white, think it'll look nice.
Yeah, but that was just like, it gave me no reason to be interested in the Slim. And then I just kind of got mad because I was like, really? A new console? I'm not ready for new consoles right now.
But it's not really a new console.
Yeah, well, that's the other thing too, is like I said, their messaging on that is just all over the place.
Yeah, even in the Slim messaging, they were talking about 4K, 4K playback, all this stuff. So then they go to Scorpio and like, what is going on here?
But the way that Phil Spencer from Microsoft pitched it was interesting, where he said that they're looking to the future beyond the concept of generations. So they're taking the Daenerys Stormborn approach and breaking the wheel instead of just assembling it.
They keep comparing it to like cell phones and people upgrading cell phones often to the new model. But I was just like, well, a console is very different than a cell phone, I suppose, in my eyes.
And I heard an interview on Giant Bomb with Phil Spencer where he addressed that and the cell phone comparison. He's like, we're not going for like an annual release and an annual update of this thing. Don't use cell phones as a comparison. And also, as for why they announced two, his angle was that he just wanted to be transparent. He's like, I don't want to keep these secrets. Granted, there were leaks all over the place before this for those guys. But they're like, we wanted to be transparent with our fans so that when we announce Scorpio next year, everyone's not like, what the hell? I just bought the Slim, the 1S. What are you doing? And so they, in theory, sided with, you know, just being completely transparent about the whole thing. But Andy, were you persuaded by the Scorpio? Do you think it's a good idea?
I mean, I think for Scorpio and Microsoft, I mean, there were certainly, I think, some flaws in their approach. If you were to ask me, like, to plan an event, I would not have ended with Scorpio, especially if you tell me this, like, they did it to be transparent. Then it's like, hey, everybody, before you leave, let's just be quick and transparent about what our plans are, as opposed to like ending on a high note, right? You know what I mean? And maybe they thought Scorpio was the high note. But for me, Scorpio and Neo, which Neo was not at Sony's, but it's been leaked and people have talked about it. I mean, I think it's a bit of a scary thing for console people, kind of, you know, I think overall, at least sort of like from what I expect from console. Like I expect to spend a lot of money on my PC, right? And I expect to kind of deal with that. And I know they said, hey, this isn't PC or hey, this isn't phones or whatever kind of thing. But I mean, it definitely introduces a lot of challenges, I think, for game developers. And some things will be easy. And in some cases, it'll be like, oh, I just made it 4K and spit it out and it works in 4K now and didn't before. But I mean, like when they scream out, like, it's got all these teraflops and all this stuff. And like to think, will someone then not make games for that because 40 million people own, you know, the older version, and there's only like 2 million people that own this newer version. Why spend all this effort to make the game so much better on that version and test multiple versions and actually not push the hardware that you had on the original? Because that's one of the things that's great about consoles. At the end of a generation, you're like, whoa, like you guys got good at this, right? Like the platform, you really started to understand it and you started to like be good at it, be great at it, right? And so I'm scared of that. And for that to be the thing that they end on, for me, I'm more like, you know, what are you doing? You know what I mean? Like, where are we going? What are you saying? And for them to have such a confusing message for everyone here, and I think confusing message for the consumer, and even at the same time too, go like, it's the same Xbox. No, really, Scorpio, it's just another Xbox. You know what I mean? Well, no, it's not. You're up there screaming all these like stats.
Yeah, but then they have that message, no gamer left behind.
Yeah.
All Scorpio games will work on all the other systems. Yeah. It's like, what is this? Like, you're powering up and then nothing.
But, I mean, is it that different from just having a medium graphical setting on a PC game versus Ultra?
Okay, I would agree with that, that there's things like that along those lines. But we're also seeing a lot of games where, like, they're shipping buggy between console and PC. That Inafune obviously has trouble putting it on multiple platforms.
The rain's going to look great on
Scorpio. You know, like, and so, like, we're talking about, and, you know, and we kind of, you know, I think fairly, we're like, hey, that's a lot of platforms. Like, we're now adding more platforms for every developer out there. And I think that's a scary prospect, right? And it's also scary in that, like, okay, I go buy a Scorpio and then, or a Neo, right? I buy either one. And then you don't put all the effort into making that like significantly better than the current one, I'm going to be pissed too. Like, you know, I mean, like, I'm just trying to figure out how they're making the consumer happy. I don't understand how it serves the consumer, I think is ultimately my problem with where we're going. And I think Microsoft, obviously, you know, they've admitted that they're kind of, you know, they're behind this generation. PlayStation is kind of running. We've got NX on the horizon. Things are, you know, coming, a storm is coming of change, right? And I think Microsoft was like, well, what do we got to lose? Like, we're in, we're changing, we're Scorpio, right? But at the same time, too, to that message of, well, and it's the same, right, is really confusing and is the opposite of what I said I want out of E3. I want to see where things are going, not be given this mysterious thing that sounds great. I mean, because I love tech, by the way, I love technology. Everyone's going to think I'm being all like poo-poo head about this whole thing. But
you're wearing a Fitbit. Clearly, you love technology.
Yeah. It's like I'm in on technology, and I'm willing to spend money on consoles, right? But I also think that game consoles get the best at the end, right? Like that's when consoles rock, is when they go down in price, when more people can play them, when games are finding more success than ever, and when the developers have mastered all the intricacies of the software and the OS to make the best games they can possibly make. And we're not even there yet.
Yeah.
And it's already, the water is already muddied, and it annoys me, in case you didn't notice.
So you want that roller coaster slow climb to the end of the generation and then the reset. You just like that pacing, that rhythm for consumers.
That's what I know, right? Not to interrupt Reiner. I mean, that's what I know. And so, like, if you're going to say, here's the new thing, it's Scorpio, it's Neo, which, by the way, sounds like I'm talking about an old thing, because Scorpio and Neo are the worst, like, things ever.
They're edgy.
They're not that edgy, right? Because in the one I see Matt Helgeson when he wore the, like, for a game, sorry, it's an old reference, is Scorpio, right? And Neo, I only seen, you know, obviously, you know, the one, right? And so, but not only are those things annoying, but neither of them are showing why it's the future, right? And so maybe that is the future. Right? Maybe Scorpio is for me. Maybe I'm super excited about it. Maybe it does change the way that video games are done. But nobody freaking knows that, right? I mean, like, nobody knows, because they came up and went, 6 teraflops, blah, blah, blah. And, like, Scorpio is dumb.
What were you going
to
say, Renner?
Oh, just looking at the arc of, like, Naughty Dog on PS3 from Uncharted to Last of Us. And it's like, oh my God, they came a long way and figured out that machine and what to do. Yes, maybe getting more power will allow them to do that too.
Yeah, exactly.
Maybe, or are they going to try something different? You know what I mean? Like, are they going to not, like, okay, this is the sandbox we know. We're going to stick with that and just make it better, better, better. Will they keep kind of expanding their scope and not really be pushing that, you know, what they can do in that one little area?
Yeah. And they will. You're right. They will make the best Last of Us 2 on PlayStation Neo, right?
Right.
But what about the Last of Us on PlayStation 4? Right. You know what I mean? Like, I'm not so much worried about that one for, like, 2 million people. I'm worried about, what does that divide mean for everyone, right?
Playing, like, on an iPhone 4, some new iOS game, and it's just...
Yeah, you know, and, like, what that does to the lowest common denominator, what that makes those games... I mean, like, remember Call of Duty on Wii U? Do you remember that? When they were like, it's on Wii. It was on Wii.
Right.
And they were like, we're going to put this on Wii. And you were like, you're going to what? You were going to what? And they did it. And you were like, this is as awful as I thought it would be, right?
Yeah.
And I'm not to say that, like, Neo and PlayStation 4 is that kind of divide. But I mean, at one point, do the developers go, well, we made a bunch of technology. We made a bunch of cool stuff. Here it is. It works here. oh my gosh, we have like 5 months left. We need to get the PlayStation 4 one to work. All right. Okay. All right. Well, this is good enough.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? It hurts games. I mean, we want to have everyone to have good games. We don't want, you know,
But if it's all in the same pool and in theory you can play these games that are coming out, even if it's designed for Scorpio and whatnot, isn't that ultimately better for consumers than just pulling the Xbox, or the original Xbox strategy of just rebooting after 4 years and releasing the next console, which has the hard line and people cannot play? It's like, this is just an option to get a better looking version of these games instead of, you won't be able to play these games at all unless you buy this new console.
That's an interesting question.
I mean, I think that's a hard line they've made to some degree. Do you know what I mean? Like, I mean, there's no reason a game has to die, right? I mean, I think we've seen back catalogs stay and last and be important from anywhere from Steam to even like the introduction of the back catalog games that they've been putting on Xbox, and people have been like thrilled about like multi-disc games are coming out and just like all that stuff. I mean, I'm not asking for those games to die with those platforms, right? I just want to make sure that when we're moving forward, that it is moving forward and making sense and not leaving people behind and not dividing what we have. Whereas like before, the line in the sand was pretty clear. I mean, we just now got rid of PlayStation 3 Destiny. Like with the
next, you know what I mean?
Like, I mean, like that lasted for a long time. Mm-hmm. But I mean, let's look at Destiny as a great example. Destiny's also been hampered significantly by its support of PlayStation 3 and Xbox 360. And they even have at their studio, they have their own, like, they build on their own box, like kind of like their own platform that is designed to output to those four systems so they can support and build all their tools and everything to work across that whole mess, right? Of cross-generational, right? And so if this next, you know, Scorpio or Neo makes everyone do those kind of boxes and kind of limits the games to some degree, I mean, that's my concern, right? Yeah. I'm not concerned about the great game that only does it on there. That I know is going to be good because teraflops, right? Like that's amazing, right? But it's the stuff that gets left behind or what it drags down.
That's the feeling
out of the new the new stuff.
Developers every generation aren't going to be like liberated again. Like, oh my god, look at all this RAM we can go now. It's just going to be this slow trudging along, carrying all these older systems, kind of sort of along with
them. Yeah, you're going to be drooling, but yeah, carrying just too much baggage.
Yeah, I mean, 6 years from now, it's going to be such a weird scene. I mean, we don't know too much about the rumored PlayStation Neo and all that stuff, but in theory, the two bigs are thinking along the exact same lines, right?
I think they're thinking as VR. I mean, I really do think that it is, yeah, to a degree, 4K TVs, but I think, I mean, you kept hearing it during the Scorpio reveal. It was Todd Howard out there, VR, VR, we're going to play VR. And again, they were being very cryptic in what devices, like, are you
in
making
theory,
your own
Oculus Rift.
But it can't be Todd Howard with Oculus, obviously, so Vive, Microsoft proprietary. I don't know. I'm confused.
Yeah. I don't know if it's going to be a revolution of the HoloLens or if they're just going to partner there. They have that partnership with Oculus, but yeah, no one really knows.
But again, if it only plays on Scorpio, you're leaving gamers behind and your messaging is bunk right there. Mm-hmm. But
yeah.
It's weird.
What did you guys think about Microsoft games at E3 this year?
Really good. Dead Rising 4, I think that looks really
so
fun.
Good.
I like the Christmas setting and Frank coming back, and it just looks fun. And
I was just excited it's coming so soon, too.
Gears of War, that demo had me laughing for a lot of the wrong reasons, but at the same time, I thought it looked like a lot of fun.
I think our stream was running really like crap when we were trying to write it up in the booth, but what did they actually show? It was just a lot of...
They had like a ricochet weapon that was bouncing off surfaces and cutting guys up, and just over-the-top craziness, taking down a tower, and...
And so you're just laughing at the absurdity of it?
Oh, yeah, there's cars flying through the air. Yeah, it was ridiculous, but I was like, okay, that looks fun.
Oh, and they showed Marcus, that's right.
Yep.
At a certain point.
At the end,
Big reveal there.
Like, we're moving forward. We're leaving the past behind. Well, no, we're not.
We got to show this guy. It's a certain metaphor, some would say. Did you guys play anything else at Microsoft? You played Sea of Thieves, I heard.
Tacoma looks good. Again, Tacoma looks really good.
Okay. And Sea of Thieves?
We played Sea of Thieves. I mean, you know, Sea of Thieves was tough because, you know, I heard a lot of people talking about it in a very positive light. Obviously, our listener said, come on, guys, stop saying, oh, butts, Sea of Thieves or whatever. But it's definitely not a game, at least what I've seen so far, for me. It was slow, cooperative, four-player game where you man this ship and like you can drink and you can, you know, you can play the accordion and it's kind of like, a sailor's life for me.
Kind of sandboxy?
You go out and you battle other ships that are manned by other people, you know, like four people, and you kind of like, you can shoot the cannons to take down their ship, but you need to work together. Like, I need to put the sails up, and there's obviously a skill to it, like people that are good with moving the sails and kind of just like sailing, you know what I mean? That you can really use the wind to your advantage to have a speed at your side. You will be a better ship than someone who's slower, less cooperative as a team, right? So that makes sense. But I mean, like, we headed off to go to battle, and for 5 minutes we sat there, and I like got drunk on the end of the thing, and I was
not in reality.
I was drinking the grog or whatever in the game, and like, so I was like tipsy and kind of floating around, and people were like, "Don't fall off the ship!" And like, and
it was hilarious though, because Andy got to a point where he's just sitting there like, "What am I doing?" And he's like, "Is there a way I could play Overwatch on here?" And the two people that we were playing with were way into it, and they're like, Why would you want to play Overwatch? Like,
yeah,
going to battle, and Andy's like, oh,
they're role playing Sea of Thieves.
Yeah, it was definitely not for me, but the people that had waited in line and were playing the game, they were having so much fun. I mean, I don't know if they were plants from Michael. They were like, oh, the Game Informed people are playing. Put some people that are really excited on the other side.
Singing sea shanties.
But I mean, they were having a blast. I mean, they really were. They were having so much fun, and they were like, I'm going to look around the ship. Oh, here's the captain's room. And which I guess the first time is kind of cool. But I literally did. I was like, I wish there was an Overwatch terminal on this ship. Is there Wi-Fi? Can I buy Wi-Fi on this ship? I could play a mobile game, or, you know.
I heard that, like, you couldn't see.
Okay, yeah. So the first time I played it, I was in a cannon, and pretty much the whole time in the demo, I was just like, this is it. And then we had to circle, and it took like a minute to circle around.
Uh-huh.
So I'm just like on the boat. It's like, do I get drunk again? And you're like watching, like, okay, we got probably about 40 seconds until we circle around to combat position again.
Uh-huh.
I don't know what to do. So the second time I played, I decided to be the captain or on the wheel, whatever you call
helm.
The thing. The helm. And
an old sailor
Star Trek
over
as well.
Here.
But I'm on the helm, and I, you know, grab the wheel. It's a first-person game, and the mast is just right in front of me. So my view of the screen is just what's on the sides. And then these guys drop the sail. So the sail comes down, and I see nothing in front of me. I can't turn my head, you know, like lean like this. I could just turn to the side.
It's like a wacky comedy where they're trying to see where to go in the car, and then the map flies on their face. Yeah.
Yeah, so then they raise up the sail a little bit. So my view is just like this on the sides. And they're like, you're going toward the rock. And it's like, am I? Which way do I turn? And so they're like trying to lead me along, like, go left, go left. And it's like, how much?
I mean, I think that's the intentional fun there.
I kind of
like
into it,
That I think you and I think is stupid, Reiner, but yeah. I think that's what, I mean, that's why those giddy people on the other side were so excited, was like that it was, you know.
I don't like communicating with people.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's the thing.
But I will say this, for E3, a lot of times games demo really poorly. They limit what you can do in the game, and this was very much just that sailing battle component. I don't know what else is going to be in that game. But it was slow.
Yeah.
And it was very awkwardly designed, I would say.
Real quick for Xbox, that State of the K2 trailer, I'm super excited about.
Yeah, that's great. Yeah, that was very exciting.
Finally adding co-op. It seems like they announced that they wanted to do it in the first one, and now they're finally getting around to it. And in theory, they'll have some more cash floating around and put some more development dollars into this thing. But yeah, I'm super pumped for that. But you mentioned Star Trek.
Yeah. Andy and I played.
That was not at the Microsoft press
conference. No, it was not. This is separate from Microsoft now. Star Trek VR from Ubisoft.
Yeah, before we go there, quick, my favorite thing at the Microsoft press conference was their Xbox Lab that allows you to design your own controllers like Nike ID. I think that's super cool.
So I guess I wasn't paying attention to this. So
you can, like the Nike shoes, you can pick the colors and the design and kind of all that stuff that you want, and then even have it engraved with your gamer tag, and then they send you that controller. It's super cool. I already did one. It's coming in
September.
I mean,
not for free. You buy it.
Yeah.
But I mean, like, instead of just going to this, you know, wherever and buying a controller, you can get a custom one if you want it. And you can make it as ugly or as beautiful as you think it is.
I'm kind of into making a super ugly controller. Is it much more expensive than just buying
it? It's like $100 if you get it engraved. Otherwise, it's $80, $85.
Did you get yours engraved?
Oh, yeah. It's got my gamer tag on there.
Why? What are you going to do with that?
It's my controller.
Who am I? Oh, yeah. Okay.
Yeah, exactly. What do you do when people ask for your gamer tag? Just take a selfie with your dumb controller next to your face? Okay.
Yeah, but I mean, like, people, you know, like, I mean, I think we're all, I mean, I think, you know, culture is across all is way into customizing things and being your own thing and making things your own. And I think it's good. I mean, even at some point, it's like, okay, it's $15, $20 more, but it's mine, right?
Yeah.
And I think that it's a fair exchange. I don't begrudge people that want to put their name on stuff. Right.
I'm into the idea of the colors and stuff.
Yeah.
I think you're going to have.
I love that with shoes when they let you design your own just because it's like, oh, finally I can get all the colors I want. And
it's cool. So back to Star Trek, though.
Oh, yeah. So this is like...
segue.
Basically, if you played Space Team on iOS, it feels like that in VR, except... Andy, do you know Reiner? I asked him about it earlier. I wasn't sure. But you can play this online, right? You don't need to have four VR...
They weren't talking about that, but it has to be.
I mean,
it's Red Storm.
Oh, okay.
Really, in 2017, I mean, that's the thing, is them like being like coy, like, oh, I don't know if it's online or not. It's like, it's 2016. This game is going to be online.
You don't have to lug your VR tower over.
I mean, it's just ridiculous, right? And so, yes, I believe with 100% certainty, this will be a game. I mean, it wasn't like it's super complicated. It's a bridge with like four people on it and some simulated space out there. Yeah. I mean, it's... I mean, this isn't Mighty Number 9 or anything like that, trying to get on 10 platforms.
I was going to say, how many times
it's actually three platforms.
How many times it's going to come up.
So, yeah, I saw LeVar Burton raving about it on stage. But you guys, what was your role? Like, how did this whole thing break down?
He was helm.
Okay.
I drove the ship.
I was the engineer, and I looked down immediately, and it's red shirt, and I was like, oh, crap. I'm in trouble. But then we had a Red Storm employee developer that was our captain, and I can't remember who our tactical engineer
was. Some rando.
And completely different jobs.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Complete. Yeah. 100%. Nobody's doing the same thing in this game.
And the captain's shouting out, like, I need 60% power up front.
Yeah. So he gets, like, communications from Starfleet. And it's like, hey, let's go investigate this space station. We're getting distress calls from it. So Andy, the helmsman, pulls us up to that thing.
Yeah, like I had like a local map and like a like a galaxy map. So it was like we were in one, like, I think galaxy or star system. And he's like, you know, move us to the other star system. So we had to go through the rigmarole of changing, right? So I needed to go from local to like the galaxy map, pick the star that we needed to go to. I needed Reiner, I think, in engineering to make sure the warp drives were up to sufficient levels. And at that point, you know, I sit and wait and like kind of hold the like warp, I don't know, throttle, right?
Okay.
And wait, and then, you know, kind of wait for... engage, right? And then, you know, send us across there, and then we land. I change to local, and then I kind of can drive the, I mean, it is like an Enterprise, so I mean, it's not like woo, I'm like, you know, I mean, it's a very slow moving giant battleship, right?
Yeah.
But you know, then at that point, I believe tactical was picking targets as we moved through, and we were trying to create communications with what was there. Mm-hmm. And so, like, I needed to get us within range, right? And so I had a speed and, like, basically just kind of which way we faced for various things. But there were, you know, requirements. It's not, like, super intense. Like, you know,
Space Team?
Space Team, yes. Space Team, there's, like, it's, like, built on like being always kind of zany and like flying at you as fast as possible.
Yeah.
That is not the case here. I mean, you are trying to complete a mission and it's trying to just show more like that there are jobs on a bridge more than you think. Right. I mean, cause like, even though the captain wasn't screaming at me to like, you know, be on, you know, get us here, get us there, I was getting targets that I knew I needed to get close to. So I was trying to be aggressive cause I knew when the ship, like when the Klingons showed up, like, I knew we needed to get there and get those people out fast. So, like, I didn't need the captain to go, like, get there in a hurry. I mean, I, like, let's go, put the pedal to the metal and got that ship moving to get it in there. And, you know, Reiner was screaming. I think he wanted to teleport me out into space.
Yeah, I was like, Captain, I have a transport button here. Can I transport someone from the ship to the asteroid?
Just
he's
floating
like,
on
no, that would be a terrible idea. But after the demo, as I was walking out, he's like, that was a good idea. I'm going to bring it back to you.
So, I mean, how much of a nerdy thrill was this?
It was pretty huge. And it's all in VR, and you're using, like, the haptic controllers, so you see your hands, and you're kind of interacting with the terminal.
And you're hearing, like, the sounds of the Enterprise around you
and
stuff.
Yep, and the red alert, and it starts shaking.
This sounds like a great nerd just daydream that is wildly impractical.
Yeah, how long was it? Like 10 minutes?
Well, I mean, it's not wildly impractical. If you own an Oculus and then you eventually buy Touch.
That alone seems wildly impractical at this point.
I saw a lot of people saying it. I know you're saying it now, but it's like, I don't know about playing this God of War game. I mean, it's like so impractical. I have to own like a PlayStation 4 and a controller. I mean, what am I going to do? I mean, yes, that is what it takes to play this game. Yes, it takes an Oculus, a PC, and the Touch things. But I mean, more than one person has them. Yes, not everyone has four in a room.
Right.
It's going to be on all three, by the way.
Oh, okay.
So when PlayStation VR comes out this year, if you have a PlayStation 4, like many of you do,
you can play the game. Yeah, and the thing is, I think the excitement is that, like I said, like I'm kind of doing my own thing, but I have to pay attention to all the shouting, and like you do kind of pick up quickly on like I'm ignoring everything. No offense. Like I'm ignoring everything Reiner's saying, and I'm only trying to listen to like the captain guy because like he's the only guy that there's a den of noise going on the bridge as like shit's going down. You know what I mean? For lack of a better term.
I like that Ubisoft's kind of taking this psychological angle with VR. It seems like there's a lot of teamwork. And then they're also making like a werewolves variant. Yeah. It's like, it seems like very simple premises that nobody would think of immediately in VR, but it seems to work.
But this isn't just a lot of times you're with VR, you're just hearing about these kind of these tests that people are doing. Very short experiences, all that.
A lot of stuff at the Sony booth, yeah.
Star Trek Bridge Crew is going to have a campaign, a story.
All right.
And it's about our starship, which was the Aegis. And we're going
down,
out
everybody.
Into undiscovered space into a place
wrote a preview recently.
into a place called The Trench, where we're discovering new stuff and doing Starfleet stuff.
What did you guys think about VR's presence at the show? This was like Sony's big opportunity to sell people on PlayStation VR. Personally, I was a little bit underwhelmed by what they were showing. There's a lot of
novelty, blown out
segments. But like, I tried Farpoint, and I thought the tech was pretty cool. Like looking down and seeing your full body in outer space, I was able to immediately rotate the gun and shoot myself in the head, which was really fun. And the guy giving the demo was like, "All right, stop doing that." but I had to stop halfway through because I got too nauseous.
Oh, wow.
I wonder why.
You just blew your own brains out.
But I feel like Oculus has been beating this drum of like you have to be careful with how you like move players in VR, very delicate. We want to make comfortable VR experiences. And it seems like Sony is just kind of going nuts, like a kid who found his dad's gun, as they say in Jurassic Park, where it's like, oh, whatever, Resident Evil 7, you can totally play in VR. You can use the sticks, move whatever you want. And then it's also in VR and look around. It seems like there's a lot more recipe for potential disaster for motion sickness there.
I heard more people this show complain about motion sickness than in the past. And a lot of it was, even people on that Resident Evil 7 demo were saying they've got...
It made me ill.
Yeah.
And it's just the movement, right?
I like to be very clear about things, about VR. I mean, I think we've talked about it in the past. That like, I mean, I always thought Sony was a little irresponsible when they're like, we're going to put Tekken on here or whatever. And you're like, I don't know that that's a good idea, right?
You know, like, just ogle some women and call it a day. That's all that crap's going to be.
They've definitely taken a more open platform approach than, say, Oculus has with their concern about just the reaction people have from VR, right? But I think ultimately I've always felt this way, and I felt this even as Oculus came through. Like, software in its early stages or software that wasn't ready or software that just shouldn't have been shown, right, made me sick, right? Like, bad software makes bad things happen to your brain and makes you uncomfortable. In the case of Resident Evil, right, I felt there's a scene where you kind of follow a guy around and he has a beard and it shimmers. And one of the things I've discovered, because I spent a lot of time in VR, when things shimmer in VR, like when they have like, we've all seen it in games when like the lighting can't quite decide where it is and it creates like kind of a like checkerboard effect that moves very quickly.
Right. Yeah.
Like Stripe
shirt in
like
HD. Mirage.
And like HD where it does that, which you don't get in real life. When I get that in VR, Headache City is coming for Andy.
And so this guy's beard was describing you as
migraine. Like, oh,
it's part of the horror.
It was definitely a horror. So you have to follow. I mean, obviously, the point of the game at that point is to follow him around. And his shimmery beard just like, it just like my stomach just plummeted over that whole thing.
God.
And it did give me a headache at that particular one. And I mean, I feel like I'm a VR astronaut or whatever. I've been there. I've done that.
When you were playing the Oculus, you spent an awful lot of time.
Yeah. Right. So, I mean, I've been there. I've done that. Like, if you're making me sick, you need to think about what you're doing, in my opinion, right? I'm not any kind of standard or anything like that. But I did see a lot of games like that. I saw a lot of games with some things I was like, who made that decision? That just seems like a bad idea. I walked away from some. I couldn't. There's one I couldn't even watch on screen. I can't even remember what it was. Let It Die or something like that.
Oh, yeah.
I can't remember. There was another like VR game that I was just like, I can't even watch this. But yes, overall, VR at the show, underwhelming. HTC Vive was doing tents where they were doing demos for people,
mm-hmm.
which I guess is good that like, consumers could get to them or who anyone like out. Like even out in front, if you just were walking past, I'm sure you could get in
mm-hmm. yeah.
and see it. So that's cool. I mean, because that is definitely the most important thing for VR is for people to play it, for people to see it. Mm-hmm. I can't tell you to like it. We're going to scare you off more with like you're going to vomit stories than anything else, right? You have to go play it, right? Mm-hmm. But you need to play software that's done. And this show, yep. because Sony was the centerpiece, because I think Oculus held back a little bit, even though they did show some new games, they weren't like, they didn't have any like kind of press conference. They weren't like, here's the touch pricing, here's when touch is coming out, VR, yeah. VR, VR.
Palmer Lucky came out and showed off an eagle flying around for a little while with Ubisoft, and that was about
it. That's about it, right? So there wasn't that grandiose display for VR, and I think even Sony kind of just had like a you know, they like had it at their press conference afterwards where people that were in attendance could go see stuff. And it was there and it was prominent. But because they were showing more early software, I think we had more of those stories of like, that gave me a headache, you know, things like that. But I think the good news is bad software like that's going to die. Good software is going to live on. And you got to make a lot of software to find what's good and bad in VR right now. So I can't complain about them mm-hmm. testing things. But there certainly does seem to be things that feel a little irresponsible to show. But that's my own feeling.
A couple of points. VR is the new arms race where you have exclusives on all these systems. You know, like mm-hmm. one of the games everybody was talking and raving about, The Unspoken from Insomniac Games, kind of a Harry Potter-esque magic game where you're mm-hmm. Discs of Tron kind of combat game, right? Oculus. You know, Sony said that they're going to have over 50 games in their, what was it, launch window?
Yeah, I think so, something like
launch
that.
Launch lineup. I mean, that's impressive, but a lot of that, you know, Star Wars X-Wing mission, which I thought looked very cool. Didn't get to play it, but...
Seems like what everybody wanted. Were they actually giving demos there?
I don't think so,
okay.
But exclusive Sony. So this is another kind of console race of Oculus is going to make first party or, you know, their proprietary games just for their system, and they won't be on these other ones.
But who's persuaded to buy PlayStation VR from this show? Who's seeing like, oh, there's Arkham VR. That's kind of cool. I can have an hour-long experience and look at Nightwing's corpse.
I mean, I think that stuff's important. I mean, I think kind of giving those things brands and things that people know is, that's kind of marketing 101, right? I mean, you know, like to go like, oh, I can play the Batman game on there. Oh, I can play Final Fantasy on there. Oh, I can play, I mean, those are like things that people know, things that gamers know, and make it easy to associate and say, hey, oh, I want PlayStation VR, right? I mean, that's very obvious messaging that's going on, right?
Right.
In that space. And I think that there's an opportunity there, certainly. But I mean, I think new IP, new development ideas based in VR are the most interesting, right?
Mm-hmm.
But that said, like Batman VR was an interesting, I mean, they basically said, hey, can we tell like kind of a weird, interesting Batman tell
mm-hmm.
in VR that you can experience some things that you would never experience in any other Batman game? Sure, right? And I think that was like what they were trying to fulfill with Batman VR. And they have some innovations there, like using the belt to like put your stuff on was kind of the utility belt being in VR was kind of weird. And actually an interesting way to do inventory. Other games I'd seen like just put the key in this weird empty thing like in space, and then that's like where you keep it, right? Like that was their solution to inventory, which is a little weird, right? You know, just like hang this thing out in space, where this has actually had a bit of like reality to it. Mm-hmm. And I think that helps like draw you into the VR experience there with Batman.
Yeah.
So, and it's early, and I don't think anyone's going to expect to sell like, I mean, that's the catch. You can't spend $75 million or $100 million like you would on like a Call of Duty mm-hmm. on Call of Duty PlayStation VR right now. You'd just be, you'd be out of business in no time. You know what I mean? You'd be in big trouble. So we have to, things have to go up slow, and we have to find weird, cool experiences and have people test things out and learn and get better.
Mm-hmm.
And it's going to be a little messy.
Yeah, I think Andy's right. Having those big brands there at the front is a great thing, because people are going to try this 15 minutes, 20 minutes, like Rock Band or Kinect. They're going to be mm-hmm. in on it, right? they're going to want this. And then it's what comes next is what's really going to matter. And that's where the big question is going to be is, are they going to have those big experiences that people are going to be hungry for?
Yeah.
Connect. They got people in the door and then they just drop the ball in that phase two.
Right, right. You mentioned new IP. We should touch on some new IP at the show real quick that we haven't talked about yet. Ever Oasis.
Yes.
This is exciting. This is Nintendo's 3DS new IP RPG that they showed during the live stream.
Yes, comes from the director of one of my favorite games of Secret of Mana.
There we go.
And yeah, also worked on like the first three Final Fantasy games. So.
And then they founded Greco. Is that what the studio's called? And they made like the Ocarina of Time port on 3DS and Majora's Mask, which like people really like technically.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, it sounds pretty exciting too. It's for me when I watch the footage, it has that Secret of Mana very vibrant world, very you know, cutesy, adorable characters. But basically, you're running your own oasis in the desert.
Everyone's dream.
Everyone's dream. But you pick.
Am I running it forever?
You pick the shops that you want to build, and then you go and you find stuff in the world to stock in it. But it's also like an action RPG where you need to recruit people to go out in the world with you and fight. And everybody has special different abilities, and the dungeons are very like kind of Zelda puzzle based that you get through. And so there's a lot of different things that it's doing. It kind of has this like Zelda Secret of Mana Animal Crossing Harvest Moon
little monster hunter
little feel to it, which is pretty cool. I think as a new, I'm always excited about new IP, and from what I saw, I am a sucker for building up and developing my own like little village or town and
Dark Cloud style.
It seemed cool that the action combat is basically you're always switching between different characters, whether it's through puzzles or even just to do bosses, because some characters have certain skills that are more useful at certain times in battle.
And it's, you said it's out in the desert. It's like Egyptian themed, right?
Yes,
like that's kind of different for these JRPGs. That's kind of cool.
Let the record show, when the stream started, I booted it up on the screen in our little booth. And Dan Tack in the back gave the Dan Tack eyebrow raise and looked at it, looks like garbage.
Do you tell him Secret of Mana?
Once that came out, then it's like, oh, now he's got to change his tune. Yeah, so let the record show that out of the gate, he had a negative impression.
Well, actually, it was interesting. Kyle, when they first just showed the trailer, was like, yeah, I don't know about this because we were in the office watching here. And then when they showed the actual footage and were explaining more about the game, he got super into it. Well, especially him being such a Zelda fan, and he immediately took to the dungeons with the, like the puzzles that you have to figure out with it. Because you have like one character they showed has like, you know, the special like little roll ability where it can get into nooks and crannies, and then the other one had a spear which could like not only just like get items for crafting with, but also like you can move things around in the environment, like stuff over, you know, like a boulder, you could turn it the other way so people could walk on it with it. So
all right,
it's cute, it looks fun.
Sure.
Those games seem to do well. People like, you know, the development process of those.
Yeah.
And I'm excited to see, like I said, if everything can come together in an interesting way. So
yeah, hey, much like a Dan Tack twist there, Reiner, I think you had a story about that cool new space shooter that Sony showed at its press conference, right?
Oh yeah, so was it transitioning from VR or not? But they,
it was, yeah, it was right out of the VR stuff. Yep.
But they start showing this incredible space battle, the scale, just these big starships, space fighters, you know.
Oh, the fidelity. It must have cost millions and millions of dollars to develop this thing.
But the guys behind, sitting behind me at the press conference are like, oh my God, they're losing their minds. Like South Park characters, like, yeah, cool.
Sony, you won it all.
But they're like, is this Battlestar Galactica, whatever, you know, they're losing their minds. And then, you know, like guys spacewalking, doing melee kills, doing that stuff, and they're just going nuts. And then all of a sudden the Call of Duty logo comes up, and one guy was just like, oh my God. Just immediately like, lame. And I just kind of turned. I was like, are you kidding me? Like, that's it?
Yeah.
Like, you're like,
yes, that is it. That is how the internet works. That is how people work.
The coolest thing ever. Nope.
I think the ball was rolling on like the Infinite Warfare reveal trailer. And just once the internet has momentum, it's so hard. We should mention it's on the cover of Game Informer this month.
Right,
we have
now
a lot of features going live in the hub and whatnot. And we're going to have a special edition podcast coming up soon. But even that, there's still so many dicky comments about like, oh, you're blowing it. When That demo, I think everyone thought it looked cool,
and it
right?
was such a great idea for them not to reveal the logo and yeah. just like Sony kind of have that having that setting for their press conference.
Whereas like EA was getting the Battlefield 1 logo in there as many times yeah. as possible before the gameplay demo started and whatnot.
In the cigarette burns, just Battlefield 1. Just...
Please remember that trailer you guys liked so much back then and whatnot. Anything else that stands out you guys really want to talk about from E3?
I mean, there's a lot.
There's
I
a million.
I mean, there's a lot. I mean, I think overall, I would just say there were a lot of very good games. I think we've got a lot to look forward to as far as mm-hmm. gamers go, which I'm always excited to leave there with things that I want to know. Particularly as like not to be all Andy Mack for a moment, but like we always know so much going into E3, just as like being reporters and being mm-hmm. fairly plugged in and like knowing what things are coming on. And to be able to leave and be excited about all these things I want to learn more about is mm-hmm. is exciting. So I think the future is very bright for games, and there's a lot of cool stuff going on.
And yeah. to kind of go into the meta of it, you know, when I watched the Xbox press conference, there was a lot of multiplayer, play Xbox One, PC.
Yeah, it's cool.
A lot of their announcements, yeah. play on your iPad and Xbox One and all this. And then I went to Sony's press conference, and it was single player.
Yeah, that is interesting.
You know, Horizon, Days Gone, God of War,
Crash Bandicoot Remastered.
Well, I mean, I'm missing all their big games. Yeah. Detroit.
Yeah, that's interesting.
They were all in on single player. Spider-Man, and I was like, holy crap.
Yeah, they were.
And but by the way, I am thrilled by that.
I love it.
A tale of two things right
Shut-ins
there.
Shut-ins rejoice.
Like, remember when Skyrim came out a few years back, and everyone was like, no one can ever sell a single player game
That was
again.
Mark Cerny who made the PlayStation 4.
Yeah. Oops.
That's great.
But, you know, and then Skyrim, like, crushed it, and then it kind of people were like, well, maybe we could make single player games again, and we've had enough, you know, a number of really amazing stuff. And that's the thing too, though, like I don't want to write off one as being better than the other, like mm-hmm. Overwatch is a multiplayer only game that I adore, right?
Oh, yeah.
And mm-hmm. absolutely love, but I also love The Last of Us. I also enjoyed mm-hmm. Uncharted 4 this year. It was amazing. And like I when people always want to say it's one thing or another, or one thing is defined by another or excludes the other, I mean, gaming's inclusive. Like, I don't know yep. why people are like, I'm mad about Call of Duty. Don't play Call of Duty. Shut up. Stop, like, taking a Game Informer, wadding it up, and shoving it down the toilet.
That's one very specific tweet we saw today.
Yes, yes. Yep. So it's just like, it's dumb, right? There's no reason to get excited about that. There's people out there that love Call of Duty, you know? Play Call of Duty then. If you don't love Call of Duty, don't play it. But I mean, these like sweeping declarations of like, you could never do that and this will never be fun are the dumbest things and what yeah. is the worst part of gaming overall and gaming people. I mean, like, I love gamers usually when I meet them, but the people that I hear on the internet that are just so like single focused, I hate them.
Well, on that note, let's check out some community
emails.
But
rant aside, it was very interesting to see where they kind of put their eggs,
yes,
you know, in
yes.
those two baskets.
Absolutely.
Sorry, I wasn't talking about Japan.
No, it's just fine. Yeah, we got to cut your mic whenever you're not talking about Japan. But we should move on and get some emails in from the readers here, so stay tuned for that. And welcome back to the Game Informer Show. We've got a bunch of emails from listeners, viewers, everybody that's encountered this podcast.
Most of the world.
My favorite part.
Yeah, I'd say,
my favorite part of the show.
Oh, really?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, fantastic. So you should pay special attention to the best email this bunch, because we're going to ship them out something
oh,
nice.
Yeah. Yeah, I'll pick one.
I think we're going to ship them out Barnaby, Andy's dog, actually.
Whoa. No, I want Barnaby.
Just
it's
in one
just
big
not fair.
Envelope.
Seriously? You're gonna throw Barnaby under the bus here.
I'm sorry. Do you not love the listeners enough, Andy? We got to do it.
Seriously?
Barnaby's going to start signing autographed pictures with his paw,
Barnaby,
and it's going to get
Barnaby's
sent out.
Barnaby's not going anywhere. First of all, because I would get killed.
All right. Glenn Kleiber from Hawaii writes in. He says, after seeing what you have at E3, what has given you the most excitement, as well as the other end of the spectrum, which is what I think we should focus on? What did you see from E3 that had you pretty disappointed? Biggest disappointment from E3. Does anything stand out for you guys?
Go ahead, Reiner. You've got an idea.
Yeah. One in particular was Resident Evil 7.
Interesting. Okay.
Capcom. If you're listening, if you're out there.
I think one person is.
Tim Turney.
Stop experimenting with Resident Evil.
What?
Doing episodic
what?
And Umbrella
oh,
Corps.
Oh, that? Okay.
Oh,
all
okay,
this crap.
That side, yeah.
Stop.
Just the demo format?
As Andy said earlier, If only they had a formula that worked.
That everyone liked.
Resident Evil 4?
No, I mean, yeah. I mean, like, yeah.
Well, they tried to do that. I mean, Revelations 2 was very much, it seems like Revelations series is going
for
that.
But they took it off the sequel, which everyone's not going to pay as much attention to one that's not Resident Evil X number, right? They're just not going to. And that was the one that was installments, right? Too. I mean,
yeah,
so it's like, oh, well, we tried this weird thing. It's totally, this is the fault. And it's like,
Mercenaries and an Umbrella Corps. Like,
there's always gonna be dumb spin-offs. But I mean, the demo, it let people play it right away. Isn't that a good thing?
It is, but that demo is not even a part of the game, and they still haven't even shown what the main game's gonna be. It's a different character, a different setting.
Yeah.
It's gonna be first person. And I thought, as I was watching, again, this was a part of the Sony press conference where you didn't know what you were watching.
Nobody knew they were watching a Resident Evil reveal.
Yeah, and as I was watching, it was in that VR section where I was like, okay, it kind of looks like a bad Condemned, kind of an indie Condemned. And I was like, okay, it's got the dumb mannequin thing like Condemned. It just doesn't look that intense. And then when I played it, I was like, wow, like this is their idea of scares, was kind of like I go over to the piano, and as I'm about to interact with it, the lid closes. I was like, okay. And then I go into the kitchen, I open up a microwave, and there's a dead bird in there. And I'm like, whee! I'm like, yeah, I mean, ooh. Like,
and whereas PT, you were scared that the PS4 was going to come
PT,
alive.
PT, like
and
a head rolls out of a door. You're like, what the hell?
Well, it's just they were very campy, like scares. That, you know, I mean,
like,
it was more
haunted
like,
house, like small town haunted house scares. And then when they get to the story, finally, like after I explore this kind of dumpy house for a bit, that's not really doing anything to me. It's like, hey, we're three thrill seekers. We're ghost hunters. We're going into this house. Pew, and you're like, okay, I'm a part of this.
Spoiler alert.
And then it goes into that. And then there's one legitimate jump scare, I would say, is there's a guy and you go down the hall and he's gone.
So for their messaging of like, hey, scares are back, everybody. You're just not buying it based
on
the demo.
And I like the idea of maybe going first person and trying something different, but it doesn't feel anything like... It feels so disconnected from
was
that
it
series.
Scary? Would be my question.
I thought it was pretty predictable. I mean, it got me towards the end.
I saw you freak out on that test chamber a little bit.
At the end. But I would say throughout it, when you're there and the guy has his back to you, you're like, oh, there's my friend. You knew when you tapped him that he was going to turn around and not be, you know.
It's not like Resident Evil to have something slowly turn around and look horrifying.
I think here's the problem. Like, obviously, they're going for a PT vibe, but PT was like its own thing and it did things so well that any imitation of that isn't going to completely work for me.
It's like a leapfrog take on PT.
I do like as I was saying in the test chamber, I do like them going back to like trying something different and going in that more scary direction. Because I want the scares brought back.
Yeah.
But I wasn't sold by that demo that was going to be, you know, because as we said, like the demo is not what's actually in the game.
Right. Yeah.
You know, and just kind of like a teaser of what they're kind of going for with tone and vibe.
Mm-hmm. And when they told me that, I interviewed the director. When they told me that, I almost hugged him. I was like, oh, thank God that's not in the main game. Because that was bad.
But
like,
I mean,
I thought it was really bad.
People like it.
There's a fan base out there.
And I'm sure I didn't play it in VR. I don't know if you guys did.
I did.
You did?
Mm-hmm.
Did you find the experience...
I mentioned earlier it gave me a headache and made me feel ill. Those things aside, I don't want to get too much into it there for anyone that may want to play it, but I think there were two items to find, like keys that moved the story forward. Everything else was me watching and just being a camera moving throughout the world.
Mm-hmm.
The jump scares were, to your point, predictable beyond predictable. I mean, like, the second that guy walked by, I'm like, I know I'm not fighting him. Oh no, he's not there.
Mm-hmm.
Who knew? And then they introduced new items that were like, I walked through that place 15 times, but the fourth time I went through, some mannequin falls over, right? It's like, I just thought, for being as important as Resident Evil 7 is, I feel, for Capcom, maybe going VR is a cool new thing, but like, make a good Resident Evil 7.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Right. And if you scaled back the graphics, which I do think looked better in VR, I do actually think they look better in VR than they do on just like a flat 2D, 2D screen, for lack of a better term. But I don't think it looked that great. Do you know what I mean? I don't think it looked as good as PT, if we're going to use that as any kind of like bar.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't think it had that much to gain from being in VR, at least at this point. So it has a lot to prove to me.
Sure. We got a lot of disappointments to get through those. Anybody else have one that jumps out?
I was so not disappointed by what I saw per se, but disappointed that I didn't see more of Mass Effect.
That was going to be mine for sure.
And me and Joe love to fight, so this shouldn't surprise anyone. But we were just arguing about this upstairs. He's like, "How could you not watch that trailer and feel like why? How could you be disappointed after that?" And I was like, "Well, after they delayed it to 2017." I just wanted to see something more with the gameplay by now, or at least hear more details. I mean, we got to see Ryder, which was cool, the protagonist, right. And some of the environments in that. And don't get me wrong, like, as I said, that trailer has me excited because I just love Mass Effect. And
the concept, at least, that's conveyed of, like,
yeah,
you kind of being
the
an alien.
Yeah.
That's a cool idea.
But at this point, because we've seen so little of that game, I just wanted something a little more to latch on to, or at least them to talk more
some
about
kind of story.
Yeah, what they're doing.
I think to some degree too, like EA set us up a little bit for disappointment in this, because last year they were like, "We have no games, so here's guys working on games," right? They showed all those videos of people like on their computer. No, it was last year.
No, I think it was 2 years ago. Like the big dev diary.
Yeah, the dev diary.
I think it was 2014.
Oh, yeah, because that was
the Criterion.
Hudson was still there, yeah.
Okay, yeah. So, like, you know, showing all that stuff. And then this year when they showed Mass Effect, we're like, "We're going to see Mass Effect." And they were like, "Or here's a 3D artist working on Mass Effect."
Exactly.
And they did some cool mix-ups where, like, they showed them doing stuff in the mocap studio that kind of finished with things that were in-game. I almost feel like you would have been better off showing nothing than what was there. But that's where maybe I fall. But, I mean, I think you can't help but be disappointed just because there's no story there. It was just like guys talking about, "Yeah, we're working on it. Hey, it's being worked on.
There's a Mad Max looking at sorry."
You know, and so I'm with you, but I like arguing with Joe as well. So.
Oh, my gosh. I was so frustrated. I was like, yes, I'm disappointed. I've been looking forward to that game for a while now. Yep. I was sad when it got pushed back to 2017. I expected it, but I still was like, "Oh man, now I have to wait longer to play it." And I thought E3 was their time to kind of talk about, you know, more with it and why that, you know, they wanted to go that way.
Other than being like, "Oh, it's going to be more open."
Yeah. Yeah.
But I mean, to be fair, by the way, I just want to point out that, like, I'm disappointed in what they showed as, like, the way they showed it and as a trailer, but the little snippets I saw
looked great.
Like, yes. Not to be like,
that's what I'm saying.
I think that's what else is frustrating,
it's like, the stuff looks great. I just want a little more.
Just like those 4 seconds of Visceral Star Wars game look great, but I think we're all expecting
the one freaking environment that they showed with walking through. I was like, damn.
You know that was the cantina, right?
Was it really?
Yeah, he was walking out of the cantina.
And what about, like, Star Wars fan Andrew Reiner here, writer of Sci-Fi Weekly, but like the banners in the background, did that give any clue as to the setting or the era?
Well, that is, so if that is the cantina, which I think it is, you look at the little device that when he walks out the door, it's right there. There's a tower in the distance, exactly like A New Hope's cantina.
But didn't Jakku look a lot like, I mean, like, don't they all kind of look a lot? I'm just asking.
Look at reference photos.
I'm no expert.
It's totally the cantina.
Okay.
So if you look at that again, you'll see there's kind of this awning up top with the flags coming down, the Imperial insignia, and then spray painted next to that one. I don't know if you saw it. There was a Rebel insignia. So it looks like there was a war there. So we'll see. Maybe that's part of the conflict is this. Maybe it's the Galactic War. Maybe they're going into that.
Or maybe there was an angsty teenager who does graffiti.
Could be. I remember you really going to the mat, though, being like, "Oh, Han Solo game. I bet my house on a Han Solo game." And they said original character, original story.
I actually like that because
I do too.
I like not knowing what to expect. Mm-hmm. And, you know, Amy Henning, who's working on it, she's just so good with character interactions that I just can't wait to see what she's going to come up with.
But I mean,
I wonder.
He's going to be a scoundrel, though.
It probably. Right? But I also wonder if they were always working on this game with the new characters.
That could have been one of their first ideas. They go through so many concepts and, you know, down so many different avenues.
And they said when the game's coming out, it's a long way away, right? I mean, it's
2018, I think they said.
Yeah. So.
All right. Andy, did one stand out for you, or should we move on?
I mean, I think for me, it was mostly just like the Scorpio thing and just the lack of information was a disappointment for me.
Will writes in. He says, "Hey, Will from London, newish listener, love the podcast." Thank you, Will. "My theory for the new God of War is that Kratos will die and the child will grow up to be the God of War." I've seen a lot of people talking about this. somewhat backed up by the tagline on the PlayStation blog calling it, quote, a new beginning. Yeah. What do you guys think about this theory?
A new beginning could just be that they're kind of going in a different direction.
Yeah.
The series.
But do you really?
I don't want to read too much into it, but yeah. That would be that's possible. I mean, I don't think that's out of the realm of possibility.
I mean, I have a theory, but I kind of don't want to say it because I feel like I'm being somewhat spoilery because I did learn a little bit. Just in that, like, the mother is not dead, right? At the beginning, when he's, you know, when he's like, "Did she teach you to hunt?"
Mm-hmm.
She is alive, right? So. I mean, does Kratos and the mother have a fight over the son? Does the son have to end the game killing the mother? I mean, I think it's going to be about, I mean, I think this game is about family strife. I don't think it's necessarily about the son becoming Kratos, right? Because there is only one Kratos, right? And Kratos has tried to die in a lot of ways, right? But I mean, I think it will be father, mother, son showdown at the end, choices. And I wouldn't even be surprised if Kratos' father is involved as well, because that really starts to drive home the, like, mom-dad issues, which I think is at the core of what they're trying to do.
What if the mom is the god of war in Scandinavian mythology? Like Odin's wife? I forget her name.
Freya?
No, I don't think that's Odin's wife. But anyways, that could be a weird twist.
Yeah, but the one thing I kind of went... I did the preview on it in the magazine that's coming out, and I went kind of through it frame by frame. Not exactly frame by frame, but the son has, like, these kind of weird tattoos on his arm, and I kind of looked him up, and it's, like, steady aim, stuff like that. It's all Norse symbols.
Oh, cool.
But he does, at one point, when he shoots that troll that comes out, it's like an electric arrow. So I wonder if he has some kind of god ability. Maybe passed down from Kratos, or maybe mom. Like,
are you still a demigod? I mean, it's 1/4 god, does that count as demi?
Yeah,
Corey in one thing said, he's like, maybe later you're shooting like tornado arrows. You know what I mean? So, I mean, I think there is... He talked about the sun like he...
This is the creative director.
Yes, yeah, okay. Corey Barlog. In that they talked about it like he is... Like, if you were to upgrade your weapons, you won't be upgrading necessarily Kratos 100% of the time. You'll be upgrading both of you, right, throughout the adventure. So... That's how you'll make those choices, is how you play the game, being like, going forward, like, oh, hey, I want to spend this point on this or that. I could make the sun more powerful, or I could make myself more powerful. So, I mean, he's definitely going to grow, but I think to Reiner's point, like, to how far, how godly would he be? But I mean, it is Kratos' son. I mean, I had to imagine he's kind of a badass, right?
And the other thing to point out is when you're listening to it, Kratos, it sounds like he's been gone for a while.
Yeah.
Which is weird because it's like this whole new life for him. And this is the first time we're seeing him in this life, yet the first thing we learn is like, wait, where have you been, man?
Well, that's what confused me though, too. And I never really quite understood that, was that, is it kind of like legend that this is just a new Kratos tale, right? Like that his past is just a different world?
I think it's literally that he walked over to Norway.
Yeah. Because he still has the Spartan rage, and then he has his symbol from Greek mythology. It's like sewn into his whatever piece he's wearing on his chest.
Yeah.
So that's a very clear connection that he was there. He carried some elements from that ashes. Of
I guess I don't. You know what I mean? Like, I don't know that I 100% believe that is proof to me. Because if you're doing like those old myths, all just like make crap up along the way.
Sure.
You know,
slow down. And wait a minute.
Yeah. I mean, so I would not be surprised. That would be just like its own thing. And
calling it Spartan rage though would be a very strange thing for them to do.
And I think that they have said that it is like the same Kratos. Like, this is a continuation of that storyline.
Yeah. I mean it.
But then who's...
Please don't reboot it like that.
Yeah, okay. Maybe I guess he's got
that means
mom.
He has the ashes of his former family.
Exactly. Yeah, that's the thing that drives... Like, not to
it's
spoil God of War. Yeah,
he doesn't want to spoil it for his kid. Don't ask questions.
And please, you should be a father again after finding your previous family all over you.
Don't tell him. I can do this homework. Like, he just starts new families again and again. He's immortal. Maybe this is like his 18th family. Nobody has any
that
idea.
Could be. He's like... The Highlander or whatever.
Yeah.
Just live forever.
Jack from Alabama writes in and says, hey, GI crew, what is a kind of game that a game company hasn't made yet that you would like to see? For example, I would love to see a Naughty Dog spy game. I feel like that one thief mission in Uncharted 4 at the, whatever the, what are the,
banquet,
auction?
The auction?
Yeah, that was basically that. Anyways, he says it would be a perfect melding of the action of Uncharted and the stealth of Last of Us. What is your ideal game for a studio that they haven't made yet?
Cyberpunk.
Just that game that's already been announced.
It's not made yet.
Yeah,
I'm curious what it is, but that's a good question. I guess I'd have to think about it more. Mm.
I feel like my answers are just stuff that's kind of in the wheelhouse of a developer already. Like, I really want, I want Lego Old Testament from Traveler's Tales. I think that would be awesome. They can take like a VeggieTales route for it. It would be, I think it would sell like crazy Left Behind numbers, Passion of the Christ numbers. They could do it.
It's true. Of it all the things audience. That were about to come out of your mouth, I did not think that was what it was.
Oh, I'm always talking about Lego Old Testament. I never stop. Or like the Telltale documentary game. I would love to see that. I think we've talked about it on the show a couple times. Nothing springing to mind?
I mean, I think
it's a tough one.
I think it's more things for me fall in lines of you know, I mean, maybe I want to see, you know, Chair, the people made Shadow Complex, get a chance to make Metroid or something like that. You know what I mean? Like, I think, like, you're right. It's like, I want to see those things in that wheelhouse. I think more than anything, I want, or I hope, that these developers have freedom to explore new ideas and do new cool things. You know what I mean? I think that's one of the reasons that Naughty Dog and Blizzard and things like that are always like, that was a recent, you know, who's better? Who's the greatest developer of all time, right? You know what I mean? Like,
I think we talked about on this podcast.
Yeah, you know, that goes on, right? Uh-huh. And I think they go on because those companies and those developers have the opportunity to try things and fail. Those companies have the opportunity to try things and find new innovations and push them forward, right? And I think it changes the level of everything. I mean, Overwatch isn't necessarily like innovative entirely, right? But like the ultimate execution, the ultimate, like, everything that they do changes a lot of things. Like, there's pre-Overwatch and there's, you know, there's post-Overwatch, right? And I think the same thing can be said for a lot of Naughty Dog games, that you play them and you go like, this is storytelling, and you go, okay, this is storytelling, right? And it changes the game across the board. So I think I hope for that more than anything is their opportunity.
One thing I've been saying, I wanted to see Bethesda Game Studios break the cycle of Elder Scrolls Fallout.
Yeah.
Do a new IP. But at the same time, I'd like to see Machine Games, the guys that made the Wolfenstein game, the great one that came out, just single player, do Fallout. Like, take that universe in a single player, like, linear direction.
Linear Fallout?
Yeah, like all that kind of weird tech and all that, but make it just Fallout? Like a, make it more of a run and gun shooter. I would love to see that.
Oh, but your Lego game wasn't silly.
No, that's
like, you gotta leave behind the whole open world, all those thoughts, and just like, what would that be like? What would that story-based experience be like?
Fans would be riding in the streets.
Because they love it.
Oh, positive riots. That's right.
Okay. I think they loved the mobile game that wasn't an open world necessarily. I mean, it's like, it's a game in the universe.
There's a lot of lore
there. Keep getting
there
more of it.
I thought you were Mr. I'm sick of these spin-offs and side projects for all these classic series. Just give us the new mainline one.
This would be amazing.
All right. Let's see. Hey, Game Informant, says Darwin. I'm hoping to hear the crew's opinion about a recent NeoGAF topic about the lack of straight, playable female protagonists. When you think of playable women in Western games, they are mostly portrayed as asexual, showing no interest in men, like Lara Croft, Samus, Bayonetta. Bisexual, with the potential to romance both genders, Femship, Max Caulfield, or lesbian, Ellie or Athena. I don't know who Athena is. Do you guys know? Anyways, even during the Harvey Smith interview on this podcast, he admitted to wanting to keep Emily Caldwell from Dishonored 2 asexual. I really can't think of a Western game with a good romance from the woman's point of view. What are the crew's thoughts on this? It's an interesting thought.
I don't think about it much.
Yeah, I've never thought about it.
There's one.
But like, to think about when developers choose to have a female protagonist in the game, but still wanting to court the male audience, so they're not going to make that female character romance a guy, but they'll make all of them bisexual, so you can still romance a girl.
That seems like that seems very navel gazing. Oh, let's go look for aliens kind of thing. At least with the way you're describing it, right?
Yeah.
That they're thinking that deep, that they're like, oh, but I'm gonna make sure that our men guys are so happy by having them talk. Like,
I don't think so. I don't think it's that crazy. I think that's the thought.
I'm trying to think of games where there's romance. You know what I mean?
From the female point of view towards a guy.
Just romance in general where I'm thinking about it. Here, like, when I play a lot of these games, that isn't even an option. You know what I mean? Like, it's never explained. So,
well, we talked on the Game Club a lot about showing the marriage, but Kim, sorry.
Here's my thoughts on it. Usually we don't have many opportunities for as many female protagonists as we get male protagonists. And I think that developers don't, because in so many other games, when there is a romance, it is the female character is brought in to be that romance item, that when they give a character her own game, they don't want it to be about a romance, to kind of make it, you know, her have her own story, that's like, she doesn't need, you know.
They're making her more independent
exactly.
that way.
Exactly.
Right. Opposed to like, you know, I mean, and I think that's, I mean, maybe that's where we're at as a growing art form,
mm-hmm.
right? Like that's where the art form is at. And I think more than, I didn't sit around and go like, oh, you know, Ellie, you know, had these like kind of like feelings for another woman and that mm-hmm. thing. I think it was more interesting at that time to be like, oh, that's cool. You know,
yeah.
we've got like
yeah.
a lesbian lead character in a mm-hmm. game. Progress, right? Like
right,
that's
right.
good. Like, you know, I mean, like I wasn't so concerned about where she was going or who she was mm-hmm. hanging out with, which by the way, should be everybody's view on everything. I don't care what people do, you know, whatever you want to do, right. you do, right? Kind of thing. And I think that's the interesting thing in like those games where we kind of push them to the sides, like something mm-hmm. like Mass Effect where you could choose either side. Like, I think those are the most interesting. And I think those mm-hmm. should always, I would rather see that as a standard as like, hey, these women aren't necessarily like engaging or sexualizing men in any way. Mm-hmm. I think it's more interesting in that like, games are better when they are a reflection of you. I mean, that's the great thing about interactivity
mm-hmm.
is that you can make things and introduce changes and introduce choice, right?
Mm-hmm.
So I think that's still very much there. I think you see it from side characters in games still, where mm-hmm. there's always some kind of like romance going on.
Yeah.
But I think that choice is where we want to go, right? Mm-hmm. As opposed to having these kind of pre-made movie romantic. Oh, no, you. No, you.
Well, and we've also discussed that like romance. I mean, me and Jeff Cork had a good discussion like a few weeks ago on the site. Like, can video games portray romance well? Mm-hmm. And so many times, video games struggle with it, which that's why I kind of appreciated Uncharted 4 for those smaller moments, because I thought they actually did things really well there. But a lot of games do, like, it's just within everything else that's going on with the game to have to like throw in a romance and build it up and make it believable and all mm-hmm. that, it's just really hard to pull off. So, and when you can have the same, like, where you do something in a Mass Effect where you have a choice and then, you know, that's kind of your arc. That's a little easier to kind of contain those arcs within that, you know.
Yeah, I mean, the games need to slow down to develop these relationships uh-huh. and that doesn't happen very often. Where Mass Effect, you do have those moments. Mm-hmm. You're just on the ship talking yep. to people and getting mm-hmm. to know them.
That's exactly.
What about just having a little one-off? I mean, like, even Nathan Drake is flirty with so many women that come through, even, what is her, Nadine, in Uncharted 4 a fair amount. I mean, but can you think of a game with a female protagonist where they are directly flirty?
I mean,
with
yeah,
men?
I gotta tell you, if I had to write a female protagonist right now, I would be scared out of my mind, right? I mean, even like very smart people are out there writing them. And I think even when they write good stuff, it's going out there and it's going to the minefield of the internet and it's getting in this like echo chamber of like, you ruined this character. I can't believe this is about this, or I can't believe this is about that. And I think even things like, I've seen interesting things in the mm-hmm. like Laura Croft's story, you know mm-hmm. what I mean? Where I think I'm like, man, like they really did a great job of like making her like believable as like this kind of superhuman, you know, like crazy adventurer. I don't know, superhuman is still the only thing I think of, because like they do so many amazing things, right? And people still are like, she's not believable. And it's like, I mean, what characters in most video games are believable? I mean, like Nathan Drake hangs from his fingers for like 50,000 hours, right? and would win like American Ninja Warrior in a second, right? And like they go through and say like, this isn't real from this female character. Like they get that microscope on them that no other characters do. And I think that's mm-hmm. just, like I said, unfortunately where I feel like where we are now. And like having a strong character, when you're trying to build a strong character that's going to go under a microscope because it's a female lead, to then be like, hey, let's adventure, you know, hanging around and like, hey, sailor, what are you doing later?
Sailor.
I mean, like, just like, just sounds like a bad idea, right?
People would crucify it. Yeah,
yeah,
sure.
I mean, I think
yeah.
it's a dangerous place to be. I mean, that's why I like that you choose what the romance is. You choose what you do. It's so much better for games and so much. Like, no one gets angry about that. I mean, there's always someone who gets angry
right.
about it. But I mean,
right.
like, it's, and not that you make games to appease people necessarily, but romances are hard.
Mm-hmm.
I think Telltale does a pretty good job. You know, that's just, their mm-hmm. games always are slower where they have
and it's about
history between characters, and you kind of believe in these relationships that are there. And they have a wide variety of things that they're showing there in terms
I'm
of
still very
of romance,
about.
Whether it's, you know, a lot of times it's not the main characters, mm-hmm. but you
yeah.
are getting to know the characters in the world. Games just need to slow down more for that stuff to really kind of, you know, take precedent. Mm-hmm.
But Nina mm-hmm. Freeman's game, right?
Sybil?
That's a very good example.
Yeah,
I didn't think about
that. That's one.
Yep.
That would be one where that happens. And I mean, that happened. And that was a game that was focused on relationship, I think, to some degree. And the building and budding of that.
Yeah, because she could put it all into that, yeah.
So, I mean, and that did it very, like, smartly, right? And so, I mean, I think that's the thing. It's going to take people, you know, writing and trying to create those kind of things that make it believable. And I think one of the reasons that doesn't come to mind for us immediately is because it was done well. Right, you know what I mean? Like believable,
it was subtle enough. It's not like that really glaring novelty example.
Yeah, like
from the
bonk 90s. You on the head. I mean, that's another reason too. That's the other reason I love Uncharted 4's relationship too. Is that like they had troubles. Like they had a real relationship. You know, like people have like that are romantic, right? And like they kind of had jabs at each other and jokes together and things like that that made them very believable and real. And one of my favorite parts of Uncharted 4.
Oh, yeah.
And I think that. You know, you don't remember the believable ones. You remember the outrageously stupid and bad ones, right?
Yeah. No, that's a good point. I'm glad we got that one example. That's a great one.
Fragments of Him has a character that falls in love with a guy. The guy ends up falling in love with another guy, but you hear her perspective of how this all unravels.
Huh. Okay.
Very interesting game, by the way, if you haven't played it. It's about this guy that gets in this fatal car crash, and you start hearing of his life through these different characters.
It's an adventure game.
Yeah, I played that at
Gamescom.
It's like
a walking simulator.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
But cool little game. Not the best gameplay for a walking simulator,
sure.
But interesting story for sure. Mm-hmm. And that does have a really strong kind of female perspective that fell in love with a guy and then you found out what happened in that relationship.
Well, hey, we're running late. What email stood out to you guys as being strong? I personally like that last one.
That's pretty good. We could go on that
one
for a while, I think.
Yeah.
All right, there we go. Darwin. We'll send you out something real nice.
That God of War one was good, too.
Yeah, it was.
About the kids. I like that.
But he was from London, and we can't ship overseas.
Oh, okay.
Barnaby wouldn't survive the ocean freighter, so we can't do that, possibly. All right. That's it for the email section. Coming up next, we're talking to Stephane D'Astous from Eidos Montreal, all about building up that studio up there and what it's like to be a general manager of a giant studio like that. So stay tuned for that. And welcome to the Game Informer show, sir.
Thank you very much for having me.
Yeah, it's interesting to talk to you. We talked to you back on the Thief cover story trip. God, when was that? 2013, maybe?
Look what I have here.
Oh, man, if you're not watching on YouTube, he has the Thief Game Informer. That's awesome. Yeah, you still have that. We appreciate it.
It was a great cover. I still remember that time as every game developer, being on your cover is like a big honor, obviously. And back then on Deus Ex Human Revolution, I think we didn't get a cover. It was close, but we didn't get one. So the second project of the studio was obviously Thief. And when we landed that cover, man, that really gave a boost to everyone. And it was a great art piece and a great article. And I truly remember that that really was a great moment for the studio.
Oh, awesome. I'm glad we could help the studio, help morale over there. So you were the general manager of Eidos Montreal from 2006, 2007, all the way through 2013, right?
Exactly. Yeah, that is I guess there's a nice story behind that because previously I was at Ubisoft from 2003 to 2006. And great challenges back then also. It was a little bit smaller studio, even though it was already huge. It was about 400 plus people. And the GM asked me to help them out to grow the company, accelerated growth, as we say, and to put in some project management tools. I was responsible for the project management group. And so that lasted 3 years. It was great. Back then we grew from 7 projects to 21 projects. It was back in the days of Prince of Persia, the trilogy, and the Sands of Time, and the Splinter Cells.
Yeah.
It was a great moment. And in November 2006, at the Montreal International Game Summit, which is an annual mini GDC in the Northeast, I spoke to some people from Eidos UK, and they had a suggestion, and they wanted me to really open a new studio from scratch, and to go up to 300 people about. So how can you say no to that? basically. So in January 2007, I flew to London, and things happened quite rapidly. I think in a meeting that lasted barely three, four hours, which is in that circumstance quite short, we negotiated, we came to an agreement, signed on a contract, and come back alone in Montreal in my in the plane, and I said, oh my God, and what did I get myself into? So their basic objectives, as you know, back then, Eidos was the largest British publisher. Mm-hmm. They had a great success, and still is having a great success with Lara Croft being done in Crystal Dynamics on the West Coast, and a Hitman franchise doing great also in Copenhagen, Denmark. But the situation is that those studios don't have the luxury to expand too much. You know, recruitment, cost of development, quite high. So they couldn't add a second project, let's say, to their existing one. So they had a problem, these guys at Eidos. They had great IPs sleeping on the shelves. And the two IPs that were clearly identified very early on was Deus Ex and Thief.
And so in that first like 4-hour meeting, they bring up those two games?
Absolutely. And so the goal was in 3 years to grow into every year about 100 people, to add one production track, to grow to eventually a 3-game development studio. But the two first projects were clearly identified. The order of the projects weren't back then. And that was also a big, big challenge. So for the first 4 months of 2007, I was very lonely in my basement, working on my laptop, doing some projections on budgets and company values. How can we be different from the other big studios in Montreal? And after 4 months, I was able to hire the first wave of senior management for Eidos Montreal.
And where do you find those people? Are you just going around to different game conventions, or how does it work?
Well, since Montreal has quite a vast and large pool of talent, I mean, in Quebec, the province of Quebec has about, at this time, almost 11,000 people working in the video game industry. Back then, it was maybe 7 or 8. So Montreal already had several studios. They had, obviously, Ubisoft is the one that comes to mind, but there was Electronic Arts. There was and also Behavior and other smaller studios. And I thought, having worked at Ubisoft, knowing a lot of people, obviously, without provoking something bad between, you know, I had a job, I had a mandate, was to recruit top talent to do these great games. So I recruited my producer, and I knew back then in my mind that if I was able to convince him, he had a great job at Ubisoft doing, working on a great franchise, trying to persuade him to come into this adventure, a startup, very low guarantee, very high risk level.
But some good names behind it, Deus Ex and Thief.
Yeah, when you mention those names, well, suddenly they are really attentive. And so that really caught his attention, David Amfazi, who is now leading the studio at Ice Montreal. I knew that if I was able to recruit him, that he would possibly come with him with his core team, which was, I mean, an added value. Instead of, you know, hiring piecemeal for this type of project would have been quite a longer and tougher task. And well, as the history says, he accepted, and he came along with Jeff Dugas, who is the game director of the franchise Deus Ex right now, and Jonathan Jacques Beltet, who is the art director. So these were mainly the three first dev guys that accepted the challenge to coming to Eidos Montreal.
How cutthroat is the headhunting in Montreal? When you were the GM at Eidos Montreal, were you constantly worried about, you know, Ubisoft coming over, EA coming over? Is it just everyone trading developers back and forth and worrying about it like a baseball trade or something?
Well, I think there were several possibilities for me. It's trying to, because at Ubisoft, I mean, there's very high profile producers that were totally engaged in their franchises, very good, competent people. If I would have went for one of those established, experienced guys or girls, I would have expected some you know, not feedback, but some resistance, obviously. But back then, again, in 2006, 2007, David and his crew were working on projects that were really interesting, but they weren't the, now they're superstars. I all agree, but back then they were almost there, and they were superstars at Ubisoft. And if I would have attacked or tried to recruit those people, the backlash would have been a little bit more severe. But having those guys, giving them their chance to be superstars, I think they understood what I was trying to do. You know?
Yeah, for sure.
So I had a mandate is to grow a company, and obviously Montreal is very competitive. But you know what? I think it brings the best out of the studios, because if the studios consider themselves, you know, top notch and not being proactive, well, obviously, if you offer something a little bit special or different to good top talent people, they're going to listen. And I guess now Montreal is, I mean, since then there was THQ that opened up, obviously closed since. There was Funcom, the Norwegian company that came, and there was obviously Warner Brothers. So I guess it was even more competitive after we opened in 2007. I think in 2009, if I recall correctly, these three last studios that I mentioned, THQ, Funcom, and Warners, announced their arrival in Montreal within a nine-month period. So that, and every studio, remember, Montreal are talking about hundreds of dev staff, not just a dozen or 50, it's hundreds. So I remember Warner was projecting 400, 500 people, and THQ had very ambitious projects. So I think, personally, the hardest part was in 2009, 2010, 2011. But again, I think their timing is everything. When people are working on great console games that last 3, 4, 5 years, once the project is done, not every studio is able to assure that you're going to be working, you know, right after your vacation, your time off. So there's a downtime. And this is normal, and it happens in every studio. As well planned it thinks it is, there's always a small downtime. And during those small periods, people are much more attentive to see if there's openings in other studios.
So it's a lot of inviting out for drinks, going out to the bar, having a couple chats, that type of thing.
Yeah, and I guess Montreal is quite lucky in the sense that I could give dozens of IPs that are worked and developed and created in Montreal. So it's like a mini Hollywood in the 50s or 60s, where people sometimes associate themselves more to the project than the studio. And that's where the mobility comes into play. So people know they don't need to leave Montreal or their local city to work on a great game or a great project. And they understand, well, I think it was back then, it was a little bit different, but I think now this parallel with the movie industry is reality a bit into a certain point. So I've seen a lot of people in Montreal working for three studios in 10 years, right after their cycle of projects, you know?
Yeah. And now we have Bethesda open up a studio up in Montreal. Yes. Gearbox open up a Montreal studio.
In Quebec City.
Yeah. Oh, I'm sorry. There we go. Is there a bubble here? I mean, how much talent? Can it really become like that big of a mecca for all these game developers? Does it need to just keep absorbing from the outside world?
Well, I think people were asking the same question 10 years ago, saying it won't be sustainable. And I think Montreal, for the people that don't really know Montreal, thinks that it's only French speaking, that we're Europeans living in America and all that. Well, it's not just that. There's a great creative industry in Montreal. It starts 20 years ago when a guy invented Soft Image, which was a tool that was really great for animation. And back then it was bought by Microsoft and everything. Afterwards, you have the Cirque du Soleil that just, I think, celebrated their 20th anniversary. Again, it's a new approach to an old industry, reinventing the circus. That's one example. I mean, Autodesk has a huge office in Montreal. A lot of development is done in Montreal. So video games is one part of the ecosystem in Montreal. And I think when someone has an idea for a project where it requires tech and creativity, I think Montreal certainly should come up to mind in the, you know, in the top three cities in America.
Yeah, for sure.
And and I guess people can ask that question, is it a sustainable thing? I think so. I mean, the industry never has been as healthy in Quebec, in Montreal. I mean, the games that are coming out, just to give a couple of examples from Ubisoft, I mean, all the Far Cry's really, the franchise really started to grow and to be successful in Montreal. I mean, with the Division and the Watch Dogs, this is for Ubisoft, but Behavior, which is the oldest studio in Quebec, an independent, worked on Fallout 4. I didn't know that. I was playing the game, which I completed, in, well, I wouldn't say 200 plus hours.
Jesus.
I'm a big, big Fallout guys. But at the end of the credit, after each game that I finished, I watched the entire credits.
Because you're writing down names for headhunting in the future. I get it.
Yeah, you're maybe right, but I think it's really to salute the people that have worked on it. And at a certain point in the credits, I see that Behavior worked on the console game. And I said, whoa. So I called Rémi Racine, who was the owner. I said, God damn, you really kept a good secret, you know? And I congratulated him, and he confirmed that he also worked on the mobile shelter game.
Oh, interesting.
So, I mean, this is one example. Another example is guys from BioWare. The next Mass Effect is done in Montreal. And Jade Raymond is now heading a new business unit of Electronic Arts Motive in Montreal, having also great projects to work on. And Warner's worked, I mean, obviously on Batman. And so if it was a one-trick pony, I guess the industry would have declined several years ago, and it's not the case. And so Bethesda, even though it's could seem saturated market for talent, came, and I'm sure they're going to be successful.
Yeah, for sure. So going back to those early days at Eidos Montreal, you talk about having the two projects kind of being the throwback to classic games of the past. Were you kind of banking and really excited about that third project being a new IP then? Was that the angle you were hoping to take things?
Correct. We were super honored to be working on, obviously, those two classic IPs. But the third one, we really wanted to keep the door open because a lot of things could happen, you know, with over 2-3 years. And we hoped to do a new IP, because we didn't want to be branded as the studio that does great remakes, even though it's quite special. I think we succeeded, but we didn't want to be branded as the studio that cannot create a new IP but are able to relaunch a new IP. So we wanted to keep that third project open.
Gotcha.
And so I think it was with David, my producer on Deus Ex, to finally choose. I think even the headquarters left us the choice between Deus Ex and Thief. Nobody had a firm position on that. They wanted to see if people that we were able to recruit were more comfortable, I guess, with Thief or Deus Ex, and I guess it came out Deus Ex being the first. But I mean, it was, and now afterwards, do we consider working with Warren Spector? Do we reach out to guys from Looking Glass and all the previous studios working on those? And finally, we said, if we do that, we really, with all due respect, you know, I think we had the talent to assume all the creative and design decisions.
So was it kind of a bummer then to realize that the industry just wasn't as, I don't know, open to new IP as maybe you had thought initially? Do you feel like that new IP is dead at this point?
Well, we took some whacks at it. And obviously, I hope that people know that in studios that have multiple project capability, that there's a lot of ongoing projects that are killed. I mean, please do not expect that every game that goes through the concept phase will make it to the end. This is not the reality of a major studio, a game studio. So we had a couple of whacks at it. And I mean, again, it's a question of timing sometimes, because with the launch of a new console generation, it seems to be more favorable to have new IPs. And so sometimes we were ready for the new IP, but the consoles weren't there, and vice versa. So I guess it's a question of risk management.
Right, yeah. Right. Is it heartbreaking to leave that behind? Were you especially passionate about that one? Or is it just heartbreaking to leave all those franchises behind? Or is it a relief? I have no idea.
Well, I think since I'm not there since now 3 years, I cannot speak for the guys and girls that are, or the managers, the deciders of Eidos. But I think it's not left out. It's not a question that it will never happen. I think that door will always be open if the right circumstances are aligned. I mean, I think there's so much talent in that studio that creating a new IP is very thinkable. It's not something that you should exclude. But this question, I think, would be better asked to David or to the head office.
Yeah, for sure. So if you're planning on having like a two-track studio from the beginning, then can you just talk about like the Deus Ex project and the Thief project and how they ran along, why you think Deus Ex broke ahead, and maybe what led to Thief having kind of a more troubled development?
Yeah. Well, Deus Ex, I think we had the good vision since day one. I think the core team really knew, after really replaying, questioning, documenting themselves, I think they really understood what needed to be done, because we knew that the community of Deus Ex was, even after a decade, after Invisible War, was very active. Everybody read the forums, the blogs, and I mean, maybe half of the fanboys wanted to do not Invisible War, but the first Deus Ex with high res.
Sure.
You know, I mean, that's a legitimate ask, but that wasn't certainly our vision to do, to adopt for the new game. And I mean, and we knew that we needed to manage the community in the best way possible, to be quite honest in our intentions, and to get them involved, get them excited, because we knew that it was part of the success if we had most of the community behind us, and if they understood what we wanted to do, that would certainly help us. So I knew at the start, we really did our homeworks. We played the game. We asked ourselves what was successful a decade ago, what can be transferred to the now in the real time. The tech has changed, and what is the strength of the team? So I think we really had a great formula, not formula, but a vision of what we wanted to do. And I think it was, I mean, the conception phase was less than 6 months, which is could have been much, much, much longer, especially for a new studio with new staff, with a new tech, with no story. The concept phase could have gone a year easily, but it was so crystal clear and so good. I mean, after, I don't remember, I don't have my timeline in front of me, the schedule, but it was quite short. And people said, oh, guys, I think you've hit it.
So the pillars just kind of rang true from the old Deus Ex games, but trying to understand the pillars of Thief, it was a little bit more up for grabs. There was too much debate about what the hell was it that made this so popular?
Yeah. Thief was also a great challenge. As big as a community as Deus Ex, certainly. I think it's safe to say that we struggled from the starting point. We asked ourselves a lot of questions. Is the camera first or third person? How much? Again, it's a game decade old, which was completely revolutionized the stealth game. But here we were in 2009-ish, 8, 9. How is stealth selling? Is it sustainable for sales? What is the right balance between stealth and non-stealth combat, hacking or pickpocketing, sorry? Is it first person, second, third person? That really weighs heavily on the animation deliverables. First person, you only have your hands or whatever, you have much less character animation. If it's a third person, obviously you need to invest a lot. That's what you see first on the screen. We had basic questions that went through some stage gating, meaning at every major phase of a project, there's a whole group that gets around the table. Obviously the guys from the project, but the GMs, I mean, the senior managers, senior directors, people from finance, people from marketing, people from PR, whatever.
And these are from Square and Eidos, or just Eidos at this point?
Again, in 2000, let me see. So if I may do a small note.
Please.
So we opened in 2007.
Yeah.
In 2008, 1 year after, there was a big management change within the head office of Eidos, which is still British at this time. In mid 2008, it was decided that we needed a major backer if we wanted to survive. And this is when Square Enix came. Square Enix purchased Eidos in April 2009, if I recall correctly. So there was a lot of changes. So
what was your good reaction to that, by the way? Thinking like, Square? Square's going to be my new boss? What the hell?
There was another major publisher. I think it's public. I know it's public that Warner Brothers had a good percentage of the shares of Eidos. And they even published Batman Arkham Asylum back then when it was done through Rocksteady.
That's right.
Who was a third-party studio for Eidos. Right? There's a web... There's a giant spider web organization, quite complex sometimes.
Yeah.
And so, where was I going to that?
Oh, sorry. So Square, it's the new management and it shook things up.
Yeah. So, yes, you asked me if, my reaction towards Square Enix when there was another horse in the race. I think each other had their strength and their weaknesses. And I think at the end, personally, I don't want to speak for the head office or whatever. Totally. I think it was a good decision because the vision of Square Enix was to become the first international group that had great success in the East and trying to conquer the West with more Westerner type game by having us on board. So that made a lot of sense. Obviously, the quality of their games, the games from Square are quite high-level quality, very great craftsmanship, and that made a lot of sense. And I think they were very respectful, very curious of to see how we did things. And I remember the first 3 months after the acquisition, we had people from Japan every week for 3 months.
Developers?
Ranging from dev guys, tests, QA guys, finance, HR, marketing. I think there wasn't one department that didn't come to see our studio. And not only our studio in Montreal, but obviously Crystal Dynamics and IO in Denmark. So I guess it's, I think the results, if I read correctly, I think the financial results of Square, the last one in 2000, earlier this year, was very, quite positive, which is really glad for them that, you know, it took a little bit more time to generate good revenues. But I think with the new CEO, I think is maybe giving a good chance for Square Enix / Eidos to succeed.
Yeah, shut down the Shinra tech and a little bit more of the money holes and all that fun stuff. So I'm curious, like you talk about this pitch meeting, we're all sitting around the table and whatnot talking about what Thief can be. Is it what every person imagines it is, where it's people saying, no, let's make it for hardcore gamers, let's make it more tactical, and other people saying, we need awesome trailers, we need action, we need to appeal to the widest possible audience? Is it just that cliche?
It's, you're not very far from the truth. I think it's one of those games, at least they're the early development, that really polarized opinions. There's the purist that wants to very much respect the DNA and the other side of the table is, will this work in 2000? It was meant to be 2011, 2012-ish. Is it going to work? Is that formula that succeeded 10 years ago going to be good and successful in several years later? So there was a lot of discussion. We went back and forth, tried different things. And I think when we finally got a grasp on the balance between stealth and non-stealth, because at first, I remember the first prototypes, I mean, you faced one or maybe two guards, and you, if you didn't run like hell away from them, you were dead within 5 seconds, which was not appealing to some people.
Sure.
And I mean, so, but once we got something substantially fun, we had another meeting, major meeting. And I remember it was in, I think in Montreal, because we rotate these meetings. So people moved for almost 3-4 days in each city where it happened. But I remember that the night before our presentation, some dev guys from Thief and the producer comes to me and wanted to show me something, a video that showed the manoir burning. It's a large building that was completely burned or being burned at the present moment, and Garrett needed to escape. And the guy said, this is an emulation of what could be seen if we had the technology of the next gen consoles. Because that type of visual graphics wasn't possible with the old gen.
And they're just being driven insane by the constraints, yeah.
And I was blown out. I said, my God, this is no. And the team, the art team of Thief, was certainly one of the best I ever saw. They were so talented. The technical director, the art director, Nicolas, really did wonderful things with Thief. And I think still to this day, the artwork of Thief is superior.
Yeah.
But anyways, and the question now was, Stefan, do we show this tomorrow? Should we risk to show this and to provoke a discussion? Or should we keep it safe and hide it in the closet?
Well, worst case scenario, wouldn't you just get more development time if they bought on it?
Okay. So the next day, we decided, I said, hey, guys, I'm so proud of what you've done. And I'm banking on the maturity and the intelligence of the people that will be around the table, that they will understand that this is a fake game footage. Okay, so this is a mock-up. This is not running through the normal engine and tools. So we show it at the end of the project, of the presentation, and people were, as I expected, blown away. And at that time, the new the next gen consoles were starting to be a little bit more precise in their release date, release window. And people were starting to say this would be a beautiful launch title. I said, okay, I understand your enthusiasm, but do you realize that we are supposed to be shipping in, I don't know, let's say a year away from now on the current gen and PC, which we agreed upon early on? But what you're asking is to extend the delivery, to add two new SKUs, the two new consoles, PS4 and Xbox One. Those are big decisions, obviously. And I think we underestimated the maybe the commercial value of what they just saw graphically. And I mean, people were this. And long story short, it was decided that at that time, Thief was going from a 3 SKU to a 5 SKU.
Jesus.
Which not a lot of games, there's some games, but early on, we were maybe the first one to take that risk. And well, the rest is a little bit history, because when you say to a runner, your goal line is 100 meters, and he's at 85, 90 meters, and he said, oh, guy, sorry, I did a mistake. You need to do another lap, and then your race is finished. And I rarely see any projects that are extended in that way to be successful, but I guess people were convinced that we were able to pull it off, and the production was difficult. As any AAA, by the way, game, it's never a smooth sailing. It's a bumpy road, is just to know how bumpy it is.
Yeah.
And I think the ticker, obviously, if you wanted to be in the first batch of release games, there's definitely a big stick in the ground where you need to finish. And I think people who took the decision underestimated what needed to be done to have, because the new consoles obviously gave us new opportunities, new technology, better capability of doing things. But to completely fill this potential is not a year's worth of work. It has to be thought out. It has to be from day one. Now we can say, I think it was a decision that I don't know if the deciders would be taking the same decisions. But you know what? That's, again, business. That's reality of every day. And I mean, we got a sub 70 Metacritic. I've completed the game several times, and I personally, I'll speak to my own name, and I think the game wasn't missing that much to be a great game. And people, I think, acknowledge that it's just missing a couple of things that would have really made the difference. That's my opinion.
No, that's fair. What was communication like with Microsoft and Sony back then? Because I'm just remembering now, being on that cover story trip, it was so... There was like this intense pressure, like, don't talk about the next generation. We can talk about it's being designed for high-end PCs. Nothing beyond that. We can't confirm it. We can't talk about it. But what was the communication like from the big two with you guys?
Well, I think any major publisher has a good relationship with the first parties. And I think we were pretty much... And especially Microsoft did a extra effort to be closer to the development family when they were, confirming the specs, and they wanted to see our expectations, what we would have liked to have in the future. And I think we were involved, if I'm not mistaken, at least a good 18 months prior to release, obviously they don't say it's for holidays when they did came out for 14.
I think 2013, so, wasn't it? I think 2013.
13?
Yeah, I think so.
Yes, sorry, you're right. Sorry, 13. Sorry. So they don't say this. Obviously, they say, oh, well, we have the luxury. Maybe it's the year after or da-da. But they really did a good, and Sony also. Sony went out of their way to really survey us. You know, what would you like? What do you think about this? So I think it's normal for the first parties and the major publishers to be talking, exchange to a certain level at least 18 months prior.
It's amazing. You hear stories about, you know, I think it was Randy Pitchford down at Gearbox saying, like, trying to convince Sony that 4 gigs of RAM was not enough for the PS4. Yeah. And they're like, okay. And I don't know how much of it is just Randy's the best storyteller. And so he pitches it like, I demanded 8 gigs of RAM. And then they did it. But are things that much in flux where it just comes down to suggestions about like, hey, Sony, make it 8?
Well, I think it was obviously every CTO is even better linked with the first parties. They have unofficial discussions and meetings and all that. That's all fine and good, but I'll always remember during GDC and E3s and all those opportunity of meeting with those people, that they were, maybe in my case, when the meetings I attended was more interested in the features of how can we better, let's say, I recall one of the twos, they were really looking to attack the boot time. The moment that you press the button of the console, in how many seconds can you actually get in your game? And I remember it was a little bit surprising because it was a major point of discussion, you know, and talking about, is it 5, 10, 15, 20 seconds? Is it really that? You know, it seemed maybe in their survey or their focus groups or whatever, it seemed that the customer really wanted to have a quick access. And obviously during that time, the second screen, all those beautiful ideas that didn't actually work out properly, I guess. But a lot of ideas came out. How can you take a screenshot? How can you share? You know, the share button on the PS4 was, it was discussed very early on, and how to have this spectating of games, you know, a bit like what was it, On Live?
Yeah.
They had very good features. Obviously, they're unfortunately not there anymore, but they had tried several things that really caught the imagination of the first parties back then.
Interesting. So is it tough to keep a secret when you know all these rumblings and rumors about the next generation of consoles?
If you see the NDAs that you need to sign, I never saw NDAs so massive. And I remember, and the proof in the pudding is when you receive the dev kits, obviously. And when you know that, oh, I heard that Ubisoft got, you know, half a dozen, and you're supposed to be in 3 weeks, and you, obviously you call, you say, what's happening? I'm a second-class citizen here. What's happening? And so, yeah, that is... That's a repeat experience that we have every time there's a new generation console coming. And the dev kits have to be in a controlled environment, so it cannot be placed upon the desk of a regular dev guy that is in an open space. It has to be in a controlled access area, and it has to be non-visible, and you need to hide out the controllers when they're not used, and the list goes on. So those guys know how to protect the secrets.
And so the developers that go in that room, they're not allowed to talk about it with the other developers, and like Sony, Microsoft are coming in to check on it every once in a while?
Yeah, they reserve the right to come unexpectedly to see if the environment is respected. And we had a couple of, obviously the account managers of both first parties are often in Montreal. I mean, they have like dozens of studios to visit when they're here. So yeah, they pop in, 15 before 12 for lunch, but they don't announce that. They say, can you just show me where you put our beautiful dev kits? and afterwards, I'll pay you lunch. You know?
Nice. So talking about Thieves development, I remember on that trip, Stephane Roy, who's a producer, he talked a lot about the struggle of like motivation, and he felt, I got the impression at least that when he came on board, he kind of rebooted things and tried to like focus things down. Can you talk about that struggle just to keep a giant development team focused and enthusiastic for that long of a development? Because I think of like a recent example, like Doom 4 or the Doom reboot, where it was also in development for so long and then they turned out an amazing product. Yeah. What's it like to be in the middle of that, of just every day not being sure where this is going?
Those are maybe the one of the toughest periods of any dev studio. It's when you know that you need to close. You need to close the game. You've been at it for several years, and all good things need to end. And I remember that I did a change in producers, and I knew Stéphane Roy since Ubisoft. And he had a little bit more of a closer profile producer type. And I think that was absolutely needed. I think in looking back, I think I should have maybe acted a little bit earlier. But it's never an easy decision to remove a producer from a game. But I must say that was one of the most difficult periods at Eidos Montreal for me. Mario, who was the initial producer, really, he was there from day one. And he had went through all this. And finally, when you finally see the light at the end of the tunnel, but still, is he the good guy to bring the train to the end of the tunnel? That's the other question. So I guess as maybe a manager needs to know when to set up for success his managers, his people underneath. You need to properly set up for success people that are leading a project. And I think I gave the benefit of the doubt. Sometimes it pays. I can tell you it pays. In my case, I gave the second chance to a lot of people, and it worked out more times than it failed. But I think the first producer wasn't the correct profile producer to close the game. And that's why we brought in Stéphane Roy.
It's going to be so tough to think of, like, I don't know this original producer, but I imagine he's a good guy and just pouring overtime after overtime, I'm sure a lot of weekends into this project, and just like give so much of a shit about it, than to be like, you're not going to do it. Sorry, buddy. I cannot imagine how devastating that'd be.
Yeah, absolutely. I still recall the day, the actual day that I announced Mario that we needed a change, that I had thought it through as much as possible. And I think for the good or the bad, I needed to take that decision. But fortunately, we were able to transfer Mario to the head office. He came from the UK, came to Montreal especially for that game, we were fortunate enough to find him a place in Eidos headquarters.
Oh, right on. So you talked about, you know, people from Square coming over and visiting your studio. What did you learn about the way they develop games in Japan, the other way?
Eye-opening, I must say.
Shocking?
To a certain point. I mean, it's quite opaque in the sense that it's not, public knowledge. They don't leave people just wandering the Square Enix building in the dev rooms, the dev floors. It's very, I would guess, old school. They were very, very interested in the technology, in the tools that we were using, because they were doing some stuff the old-fashioned way that was done maybe 10 years or 15 years ago, but the same way today. And because they were able, their level of craftsmanship is so high, it requires just lots of hours. It's not efficient in a business way, but it looks like crazily nice.
Yeah.
And, you know, I mean, I remember looking at a couple of characters from
is it 13?
Yeah.
Okay.
That's it. From 13. And I mean, it's mind boggling how they are able to manipulate certain parts of the graphic. But once you know how much time and what type of artist is required to do that, they say, that is good for the user, but not good for business, in the sense, if you put your business hat, you say, this is like doing a car in the same methods of Henry Ford into a certain point. You know, they're beautiful, they're handcrafted, but nowadays there's ways to do things differently. I'm not saying necessarily, I don't want to shock the purists that say old school is good and that's the only thing that exists. But they were sometimes, and in tech, they're, how can I say this politely? They were a little bit further behind from what I would have thought in their tech.
But, okay.
Art and design, I mean, they're shining examples and all that. But the tech, in a general term, is not made to support this as well.
Totally. Yeah, I heard similar thoughts, like Tim Longo, who's the original creative director for the reboot of Tomb Raider, and then he went on to do Halo 5 and stuff. He has a podcast where he plays old games, and he was playing through Final Fantasy IX, and he could just not fathom looking at it. He's like, there's so many handcrafted one-offs, not part of any system, that is just made by hand just for this one specific instance and then thrown away. Just one-off systems and mechanics. And I think it's just that aspect that's mind-boggling to Western developers.
Yeah,
and exactly. Why is that? Is it just lack of communication? Is it stubbornness from the corporation's part to be like, hey, this is Final Fantasy, we're going to take our time with this?
There's that. I mean, Final Fantasy, you don't mess around with at Square Enix. And I think it's a general impression that the Japanese don't really like risk. I think it's embedded in their culture. And I think they prefer to go the long route with something they know.
Interesting.
Than maybe taking a shorter route with, to their eyes, unproven, tested mechanics that they are used to work with. So they prefer to go the other way. And which I totally respect, you know. I mean, they do great games, but they're made differently.
I think the outsider's perspective on, you know, Western versus Eastern Square is, I think people project that there must be a lot of frustration with the Western developers, because you look at a game like Final Fantasy 15, which was originally versus 13, being worked on for 10 years, and then you get so many stories about like, oh, you know, the Western games didn't quite live up to expectations. It feels like they are on different planets. They're on different timetables and levels of crunch and pressure. Is that a fair read on it? Is that inaccurate to have that view?
I think so. I think you're very close to my opinion. I think the time aspect, you know, in project management, you have this three-legged chair: money, time, quality. You need to manage a good balance. And obviously, if I come back to Final Fantasy, one leg that will never budge or be compromised is the quality one. So very often, the two others need to balance it. So it takes more time and more money. And this is how they were able to be successful, respecting this type of balance. So we should not be surprised that they are continuing in this vein, while be curious to see how the Westerners are doing things. And I think it's just a question of time where there's going to be a certain, not big change, but I think they understand that they need to do something different to be able to have something sustainably successful and commercially hitting the targets.
Yeah,
because spending 5 years on a dev project is not a synonym of commercial success. Obviously, normally should be beautiful, should be well balanced, should be tweaked, should be bugless, but it's not always the case.
So how often did you have conversations that were just, hey, Square, how about you give Deus Ex the resources and the time and the respect before being a classic franchise like Final Fantasy gets?
I have a great story now, and thanks for reminding me. It was, I think, 4 months prior to the official announcement of Deus Ex Human Revolution. We had our heads down on the production, dev, everything, and we overlooked what we needed to have as marketing assets, okay, for the launch. So you don't just say, hey guys, we're doing Deus Ex, and here's the logo, and bye-bye. You need to have something really eye candy.
Need some screenshots for magazines.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay.
We like to see something moving. So I remember it was, now it comes back to me, it was a couple of months right after the acquisition of Square Enix purchasing, acquiring Eidos. So this was in April, if I recall correctly, 9. So early autumn, this is where we questioned ourselves, we need to have a trailer for Deus Ex. There was the initial trailer, but it was way early. Now we needed to show something really substantial. I call my CEO. I say, I think I have a good idea to have an excuse to have us already collaborate. What do you think if we asked, now the name, I don't remember, visual work, the studio who does the cinematics of Square Enix that were responsible for the Final Fantasy visual works.
Yeah.
I think that was the internal studio name. I would like to see if they're maybe interested or curious if they could help us doing a trailer. And my boss says, yeah, why not? Go ahead. Do I need an introduction or something? You know, so just say you're the GM and yeah. So call this guy. So I write this guy, and in fact, there was a translator because they needed to translate all the emails and all that. And long story short, Visual Works never worked on anything else than Final Fantasy and the other major IPs, doing unbelievable trailers. They say yes. So I said to myself, great. I mean, this is the first sign of collaboration between both groups. Now we need to come up with a storyline and, you know, to structure, because we were not sure if they were totally understanding what we wanted to project with the Deus Ex. So we had hired just a month earlier guys from Vancouver that really helped us. I want to give them a little commercial. It's Goldtooth Studios in Vancouver really helped us putting the storyline of this trailer. And we totally had confidence that they understood the DNA of the game and what needed to be shown as the first real trailer. And we knew they didn't have the bandwidth to create the CG trailer. And so now, after the Japanese said yes, I need to say, but by the way, you will need to work with one of our outsourcer who did a great job on the story, and we need you to make it happen. So this wasn't so obvious, because normally Visual Works is the master of what they want to do. Basically, nobody tells them what they need to do. They know what to do, but in this case, ask them to work on a Westerner project, sci-fi, but by the way, the storyline has been written and we have approved it, but we need you to make it happen. And long story short, you remember the E3 trailer? Now, I don't want to get my years mixed up. Is it 10 or 9? It's one of the most beautiful trailers I have personally being implicated with, and it was a great collaboration between Eidos Montreal, Goldtooth in Vancouver and Visual Works in Tokyo. And there was even an extended version of like 10 or 11, 12 minutes. And we had so much difficulty to cut off some parts of it because it was just f-ing beautiful. And I remember at the end, the credits come up like a movie because we really thought it was a piece of art.
Yeah.
And I'm sure that you've seen this trailer. It was very popular, but the extended version is like a mini movie. And we almost, I think, suggested this trailer to be in festivals of animation to win some prizes because it was just this good.
So it's good.
So that was one example of a calibration.
I thought you were building towards it being a complete disaster and them being complete prima donnas that don't want to work with this other outsource.
No. One thing you need to know if you want to be successful, you need to know your strengths and weaknesses and your core expertise, and you need to go get the right people to do the right mandate. And in this case, I repeat, Goldtooth, these guys really saved our asses several times. It's I think an ongoing collaboration right now with the studio. They had worked on the Thief trailer. It's not just a one-off. One of my responsibilities at GM was to really create alliances or at least strategic partners, not just for the one quick hit and see you by. It was a very successful partnership.
Oh, nice. Great. So now that you're kind of out of the fray of AAA game development, I mean, do you look back on it and just think, man, what an insane business? Or what are your thoughts? Do you think it's sustainable? Do you think it's the scariest business you've ever been in? What are your thoughts on just AAA game development in general now that you're out of it?
Good question. I mean, prior to the video game industry, I was in the aerospace industry for 8 years. So it was quite a shock, obviously, for me coming into the video game early 2000. Obviously, my initial assumptions was, it's not as serious as aerospace, and I've learned quite rapidly what I really think is unique in the video game industry. It's one of those rare form of art, entertainment, call it what you want, that really brings the best of tech and creative people together. I do not really know if there's another product, service, call it what you want, but as a deliverable, if somebody knows a product that reunites tech and art together, I don't know anything better than a video game, which is the great, I wouldn't say mystery, but the great uniqueness of video games. There's no other tech or industry or art, pure art, that really reunites those two elements, which is magic for me. So
so it's, attractive.
Sorry?
So it's attractive. It's an attractive industry, but...
But it's a challenging for a manager because normally managers have a tech background or a lot less managers have an art or a creative sensibility. But a good manager in a video game, I'm an industrial designer by training. I did my MBA, but... My initial degree was industrial design, which is architecture of products. And you need to work a product with a need, but there's creativity and technical elements, obviously. And this was that. This really was the only that I know of, the industry that really presents the best challenges for this type of management, because doing a product, a regular repeated product, is less challenging, is maybe there's more challenges in control, cost, quality. But when you create, when you do a creation, a creative technical product, there's not a lot of people that can really handle both.
Yeah.
So that, I think, is quite the uniqueness of video games.
Yeah. And so AAA game development doesn't scare you anymore? So are you thinking about getting back into it at any point?
Well, after Eidos, what I wanted to do was to kick the tires of the mobile game. And I wanted to work for a local owner, meaning not a foreign subsidiary. So I work for French people, for a French corporation, a British corporation, and a Japanese corporation. And I'm very proud about Montreal. I refused a lot of relocation offers that were very appealing because I think Montreal really has something special and I want to make it grow. So I wanted to join a fast-growing, up-and-coming studio that does mobile. And for a year, I worked at Ibernium, who are doing quite well. They had a launch project on the Fire Phone of Amazon. Obviously, it hasn't been a successful launch for the phone, but just being asked to I think there were two or three developers that were asked to do a launch native game on the phone, and they have great clients. I don't just if you look at their website, they're doing great. And so that was quite interesting. Now, I think I have done pretty much, as we say in French, once you've done the, you've marched around the garden and you've seen pretty much everything.
Okay.
I'm now maybe seeking, you know, I would be certainly open to for the right opportunity. And right now I'm doing consulting mandates, which is great. I'm helping out indie companies, you know, trying to advise them and to give them some advice. And that is fun, but I'm always looking for the right situation. I've been talking with maybe more tech groups right now. There's a good startup community in Montreal. There's some even companies coming from San Francisco to Montreal because, you know, the cost of the West Coast is becoming quite a big factor.
It's stupid,
success.
Yeah.
And so, I mean, I'm really, really proud of and glad to have gone through, you know, the console and some mobile experience. And yeah, great experience.
Man, you've seen a lot. You've worked with a Japanese company. You've seen the console transition. I mean, there's so many details in it. That's crazy. But I really, really appreciate your time, Stephane. Thank you so much. You were a pleasure to just immediately get back to me and be like, yep, I'm up for talking for a long time. So it's always nice it's nice to catch up with people that we see briefly on a cover story trip years down the road.
Thanks, guys.
Yeah.
You're doing a great job. Thank you.
Thanks a lot. And thank you for watching or listening to this episode of the Game Informer Show. Be sure to tune in next week and we'll have a new episode waiting for you. Bye, everybody.